This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Yas Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Woodhouse. Chapter 1. Inasmuch as the scene of this story is that historic pile, Belfour Castle, in the country of Hampshire, it would be an agreeable task to open it with a leisurely description of the place, followed by some notes on the history of the Earls of Marshmoreton, who have owned it since the 15th century. Unfortunately, in these days of rush and hurry, a novelist works at a disadvantage. He must leap into the middle of his tale with as little delay as he would employ in boarding a moving tram-car. He must get off the mark with the smooth swiftness of a jack-rabbit surprised while lunching. Otherwise people throw him aside and go out to picture palaces. I may briefly remark that the present Lord Marshmoreton is a widower of some 48 years, that he has 2 children, a son, Percy Wilbraham Marsh, Lord Belfour, who is on the brink of his 21st birthday, and a daughter, Lady Patricia Maud Marsh, who is just 20. That the chatelaine of the castle is Lady Caroline Byng, Lord Marshmoreton's sister, who married the very wealthy colliery owner, Clifford Byng, a few years before his death, which unkind people say she hastened, and that she has a stepson, Reginald. Give me time to mention these few facts, and I am done. On the glorious past of the Marshmoretons I will not even touch. Luckily, the loss to literature is not irreparable. Lord Marshmoreton himself is engaged upon a history of the family, which will doubtless be on every bookshelf as soon as his lordship gets it finished. And, as for the castle and its surroundings, including the model dairy and the amber drawing-room, you may see them for yourself any Thursday, when Belfour is thrown open to the public on payment of a fee of 1 shilling a head. The money is collected by Keggs, the butler, and goes to a worthy local charity. At least, that is the idea. But the voice of calumny is never silent, and there exists a school of thought, headed by Albert the page-boy, which holds that Keggs sticks to these shillings like glue, and adds them to his already considerable savings in the Farmers and Merchants' Bank, on the left side of the High Street in Belfour Village, next door to the Oddfellows Hall. With regard to this, one can only say that Keggs looks far too much like a particularly saintly bishop to indulge in any such practices. On the other hand, Albert knows Keggs. We must leave the matter open. Of course, appearances are deceptive. Anyone, for instance, who had been standing outside the front entrance of the castle at 11 o'clock on a certain June morning might easily have made a mistake. Such a person would probably have jumped to the conclusion that the stately middle-aged lady of a determined cast of countenance, who was standing near the rose garden, talking to the gardener, and watching the young couple strolling on the terrace below, was the mother of the pretty girl, and that she was smiling because the latter had recently become engaged to the tall, pleasant-faced youth at her side. Sherlock Holmes himself might have been misled. One can hear him explaining the thing to Watson in one of those lightning flashes of inductive reasoning of his.
"It is the only explanation, my dear Watson. If the lady were merely complimenting the gardener on his rose garden, and if her smile were merely caused by the excellent appearance of that rose garden, there would be an answering smile on the face of the gardener. But, as you see, he looks morose and gloomy."
As a matter of fact, the gardener, that is to say, the stocky, brown-faced man in shirt-sleeves and corduroy trousers, who was frowning into a can of whale-oil solution, was the Earl of Marshmoreton. And there were 2 reasons for his gloom. He hated to be interrupted while working, and furthermore, Lady Caroline Byng always got on his nerves, and never more so than when, as now, she speculated on the possibility of a romance between her stepson, Reggie, and his lordship's daughter, Maud. Only his intimates would have recognized in this curious corduroy-trousered figure the 7th Earl of Marshmoreton.
the Lord Marshmoreton who made intermittent appearances in London, who lunched among bishops at the Athenaeum Club without exciting remark, was a correctly dressed gentleman whom no one would have suspected of covering his sturdy legs in anything but the finest cloth. But if you will glance at your copy of Who's Who, and turn up the M's, you will find in the space allotted to the Earl the words Hobby, Gardening, to which, in a burst of modest pride, his lordship has added, Awarded first prize for hybrid teas, Temple Flower Show, 1911. The words tell their own story. Lord Marshmoreton was the most enthusiastic amateur gardener in a land of enthusiastic amateur gardeners. He lived for his garden. The love which other men expend on their nearest and dearest, Lord Marshmoreton lavished on seeds, roses, and loamy soil. The hatred which some of his order feel for socialists and demagogues, Lord Marshmoreton kept for rose slugs, rose beetles, and the small, yellowish-white insect which is so depraved and sinister a character that it goes through life with an alias, being sometimes called a rose-hopper and sometimes a thrips. A simple soul, Lord Marshmoreton, mild and pleasant. Yet put him among the thrips, and he became a dealer out of death and slaughter, a destroyer in the class of Attila the Hun and Genghis Khan. Thrips feed on the underside of rose leaves, sucking their juice and causing them to turn yellow. And Lord Marshmoreton's views on these things were so rigid that he would have poured whale oil solution on his grandmother if he had found her on the underside of one of his rose leaves, sucking its juice. The only time in the day when he ceased to be the horny-handed toiler and became the aristocrat was in the evening after dinner, when, egged on by Lady Caroline, who gave him no rest in the matter, he would retire to his private study and work on his History of the Family, assisted by his able secretary, Alice Faraday. His progress on that massive work was, however, slow. 10 hours in the open air made a man drowsy, and too often Lord Marshmoreton would fall asleep in mid-sentence, to the annoyance of Miss Faraday, who was a conscientious girl and liked to earn her salary. The couple on the terrace had turned. Reggie Byng's face, as he bent over Maud, was earnest and animated, and even from a distance it was possible to see how the girl's eyes lit up at what he was saying. She was hanging on his words. Lady Caroline's smile became more and more benevolent. "They make a charming pair," she murmured. "I wonder what dear Reggie is saying. Perhaps at this very moment—" She broke off with a sigh of content. She had had her troubles over this affair. Dear Reggie, usually so plastic in her hands, had displayed an unaccountable reluctance to offer his agreeable self to Maud, in spite of the fact that never— Not even on the public platform which she adorned so well had his stepmother reasoned more clearly than she did when pointing out to him the advantages of the match. It was not that Reggie disliked Maud. He admitted that she was a topper on several occasions, going so far as to describe her as absolutely priceless. But he seemed reluctant to ask her to marry him. How could Lady Caroline know that Reggie's entire world, or such of it as was not occupied by racing cars and golf, was filled by Alice Faraday? Reggie had never told her. He had not even told Miss Faraday. "Perhaps at this very moment," went on Lady Caroline, "the dear boy is proposing to her." Lord Marshmoreton grunted, and continued to peer with a questioning eye in the awesome brew which he had prepared for the thrips. "One thing is very satisfactory," said Lady Caroline. "I mean that Maud seems entirely to have got over that ridiculous infatuation of hers for that man she met in Wales last summer. She could not be so cheerful if she was still brooding on that. I hope you will admit now, John, that I was right in keeping her practically a prisoner here and never allowing her a chance of meeting that man again, either by accident or design. They say absence makes the heart grow fonder. Stuff! A girl of Maud's age falls in and out of love half a dozen times a year. I feel sure she has almost forgotten the man by now." "Eh?" said Lord Marshmoreton. His mind had been far away, dealing with green flies.
"I was speaking about that man Maud met when she was staying with Brenda in Wales."
"Oh, yes."
"Oh, yes," echoed Lady Caroline, annoyed.
"Is that the only comment you can find to make? Your only daughter becomes infatuated with a perfect stranger, a man we have never seen, of whom we know nothing, not even his name, nothing except that he is an American and hasn't a penny. Maud admitted that. And all you say is, oh, yes."
"But it's all over now, isn't it? I understood the dashed affair was all over."
"We hope so. But I should feel safer if Maud were engaged to Reggie. I do think you might take the trouble to speak to Maud."
"Speak to her? I do speak to her."
Lord Marshmoreton's brain moved slowly when he was preoccupied with his roses.
"We're on excellent terms."
Lady Caroline frowned impatiently. Hers was an alert, vigorous mind, bright and strong like a steel trap, and her brother's vagueness and growing habit of inattention irritated her.
"I mean to speak to her about becoming engaged to Reggie. You are her father. Surely you can at least try to persuade her."
"Can't coerce a girl."
"I never suggested you should coerce her, as you put it. I merely meant that you could point out to her, as a father, where her duty and happiness lie."
"Drink this!"
cried his lordship with sudden fury, spraying his can over the nearest bush, and addressing his remark to the invisible Thripps. He had forgotten Lady Caroline completely.
"Don't stint yourselves, there's lots more."
A girl came down the steps of the castle and made her way towards them. She was a good-looking girl, with an air of quiet efficiency about her. Her eyes were grey and whimsical, her head was uncovered, and the breeze stirred her dark hair. She made a graceful picture in the morning sunshine, and Reggie Byng, sighting her from the terrace, wobbled in his tracks, turned pink, and lost the thread of his remarks. The sudden appearance of Alice Faraday always affected him like that.
"I have copied out the notes you made last night, Lord Marshmoreton. I typed two copies."
Alice Faraday spoke in a quiet, respectful, yet subtly authoritative voice. She was a girl of great character. Previous employers of her services as secretary had found her a jewel. To Lord Marshmoreton she was rapidly becoming a perfect incubus. Their views on the relative importance of gardening and family histories did not coincide. To him the history of the Marshmoreton family was the occupation of the idle hour. She seemed to think that he ought to regard it as a life work. She was always coming and digging him out of the garden, and dragging him back to what should have been a purely after-dinner task. It was Lord Marshmoreton's habit, when he awoke after one of his naps, too late to resume work, to throw out some vague promise of attending to it tomorrow. But, he reflected bitterly, the girl ought to have tact and sense to understand that this was only polite persiflage, and not to be taken literally. "They are very rough," continued Alice, addressing her conversation to the seat of his lordship's corduroy trousers. Lord Marshmoreton always assumed a stooping attitude when he saw Miss Faraday approaching with papers in her hand, for he laboured under a pathetic delusion, of which no amount of failures could rid him, that if she did not see his face, she would withdraw.
"You remember last night you promised you would attend to them this morning?"
She paused long enough to receive a non-committal grunt by way of answer.
"Of course, if you're busy,"
she said placidly, with a half-glance at Lady Caroline. That masterful woman could always be counted on as an ally in these little encounters.
"Nothing of the kind," said Lady Caroline crisply.
She was still ruffled by the lack of attention which her recent utterances had received, and welcomed the chance of administering discipline.
"Get up at once, John, and go in and work."
"I am working," pleaded Lord Marshmoreton.
Despite his 48 years, his sister Caroline still had the power at times to make him feel like a small boy. She had been a great martinet in the days of their mutual nursery.
"The family history is more important than grubbing about in dirt. I cannot understand why you do not leave this sort of thing to MacPherson. Why you should pay him liberal wages and then do his work for him, I cannot see. You know the publishers are waiting for the history. Go and attend to these notes at once."
"You promised you would attend to them this morning, Lord Marshmoreton," said Alice invitingly.
Lord Marshmoreton clung to his can of whale oil solution with the clutch of a drowning man. None knew better than he that these interviews, especially when Caroline was present to lend the weight of her dominating personality, always ended the same way.
"Yes, yes, yes, yes," he said. "Tonight, perhaps. After dinner, eh? Yes, after dinner. That will be capital."
"I think you ought to attend to them this morning," said Alice, gently persistent. It really perturbed this girl to feel that she was not doing work enough to merit her generous salary. And on the subject of the history of the Marshmoreton family, she was an enthusiast. It had a glamour for her. Lord Marshmoreton's fingers relaxed their hold. Throughout the rose garden, hundreds of spared thrips went on with their morning meal, unwitting of doom averted.
"Oh, all right, all right. Come into the library."
"Very well, Lord Marshmoreton." Miss Faraday turned to the Lady Caroline. "I have been looking up the trains, Lady Caroline. The best is the 12:15. It has a dining car and stops at Belfer if signalled."
"Are you going away, Caroline?" inquired Lord Marshmoreton hopefully.
"I am giving a short talk to the Social Progress League at Lewisham. I shall return tomorrow."
"Oh," said Marshmoreton, hope fading from his voice.
"Thank you, Miss Faraday," said Lady Caroline. "The 12:15. The motor will be round at 11:45. Thank you. Oh, by the way, Miss Faraday, will you call to Reggie as you pass and tell him I wish to speak to him?"
Maud had left Reggie by the time Alice Faraday reached him, and that ardent youth was sitting on a stone seat, smoking a cigarette and entertaining himself with meditations in which thoughts of Alice competed for precedence with graver reflections connected with the subject of the correct stance for his approach shots. Reggie was a troubled spirit these days. He was in love, and he had developed a bad slice with his mid-iron. He was practically a soul in torment.
"Lady Caroline asked me to tell you that she wishes to speak to you, Mr. Byng."
Reggie leaped from his seat. "Hullo, hullo, hullo! There you are! I mean to say, what?" He was conscious, as was his custom in her presence, of a warm, prickly sensation in the small of the back. Some kind of elephantiasis seemed to have attacked his hands and feet, swelling them to enormous proportions. He wished profoundly that he could get rid of this habit of yelping with nervous laughter whenever he encountered the girl of his dreams. It was calculated to give her a wrong impression of a chap, make her think him a fearful chump and what not.
"Lady Caroline is leaving by the 12:15.
"That's good. What I mean to say is, oh, she is she? I see what you mean."
The absolute necessity of saying something, at least moderately coherent, gripped him. He rallied his forces.
"You wouldn't care to come for a stroll after I've seen the mater, or a row on the lake, or any rot like that, would you?"
"Thank you very much, but I must go in and help Lord Marshmoreton with his book."
"What a rotten... what a damn shame!"
The pity of it tore at Reggie's heartstrings. He burned with generous wrath against Lord Marshmoreton, that modern Simon Legree, who used his capitalistic power to make a slave of this girl and keep her toiling indoors when all the world was sunshine.
"Shall I go and ask him if you can't put it off till dinner?"
"Oh, no, thanks very much. I'm sure Lord Marshmoreton wouldn't dream of it."
She passed on with a pleasant smile. When he had recovered from the effect of this, Reggie proceeded slowly to the upper level to meet his stepmother. "Hullo, mater. Pretty fit and so forth. What did you want to see me about?"
"Well, Reggie, what is the news?"
"Eh, what? News? Didn't you get hold of a paper at breakfast? Nothing much in it. Tam Duggan beat Alec Fraser 3-2 to play at Prestwick. I didn't notice anything else much. There's a new musical comedy at the Regal, open last night, and seems to be just like Mother makes. The Morning Post gives it a topping notice. I must trickle up to town and see it sometime this week." Lady Caroline frowned. This slowness in the uptake, coming so soon after her brother's inattention, displeased her.
"No, no, no! I mean, you and Maud have been talking to each other for quite a long time, and she seemed very interested in what you were saying. I hope you might have some good news for me."
Reggie's face brightened. He caught her drift.
Yes, I see what you mean. No, there wasn't anything of the sort, shape or order."
"What were you saying to her, then, that interested her so much?"
"I was explaining how I landed dead on the pin with my spoon out of a sand-trap at the 11th hole yesterday. It certainly was a pretty ripe shot, considering. I'd sliced into this baby bunker, don't you know? I simply can't keep 'em straight with the iron nowadays. And there the pill was, grinning up at me from the sand. Of course, strictly speaking, I ought to have used a niblick, but..."
"Do you mean to say, Reggie, that with such an excellent opportunity you did not ask Maud to marry you?"
"I see what you mean. Well, as a matter of absolute fact, I, as it were, didn't."
Lady Caroline uttered a wordless sound.
"By the way, mater," said Reggie, "I forgot to tell you about that. It's all off."
"What?"
"Absolutely. You see, it appears there's a chappie unknown for whom Maud has an absolute pash. It seems she met this sportsman up in Wales last summer. She was caught in the rain, and he happened to be passing and rallied round with his raincoat, and one thing led to another. Always raining in Wales, what? Good fishing, though, here and there. Well, what I mean is, this cove was so deucedly civil, and all that, and now she won't look at anybody else. He's the blue-eyed boy, and everybody else is an also-ran, with about as much chance as a blind man with one arm trying to get out of a bunker with a toothpick."
"What perfect nonsense! I know all about that affair. It was just a passing fancy that never meant anything. Maud has got over that long ago."
"She didn't seem to think so."
"Now, Reggie," said Lady Caroline tensely, "please listen to me. You know that the castle will be full of people in a day or two for Percy's coming of age, and this next few days might be your last chance of having a real long private talk with Maud. I shall be seriously annoyed if you neglect this opportunity. There is no excuse for the way you are behaving. Maud is a charming girl."
"Oh, absolutely, one of the best."
"Very well, then."
"But, mater, what I mean to say is..."
"I don't want any more temporizing, Reggie."
"No, no, absolutely not," said Reggie dutifully, wishing he knew what the word meant, and wishing also that life had not become so frightfully complex.
"Now, this afternoon, why should you not take Maud for a long ride in your car?"
Reggie grew more cheerful. At least he had an answer for that. "Can't be done, I'm afraid. I've got to motor into town to meet Percy. He's arriving from Oxford this morning. I promised to meet him in town and tool him back in the car."
"I see. Well, then, why couldn't you..."
"I say, mater, dear old soul," said Reggie hastily, "I think you'd better tear yourself away and what not. If you're catching the 12:15, you ought to be staggering round to see if you haven't forgotten anything. There's the car coming round now."
"I wish now I had decided to go by a later train."
"No, no, mustn't miss the 12:15. Good fruity train. Everybody speaks well of it. Well, see you anon, mater. I think you'd better run like a hare."
"You will remember what I said?"
"Oh, absolutely."
"Good-bye, then. I shall be back tomorrow."
Reggie returned slowly to his stone seat. He breathed a little heavily as he felt for his cigarette case. He felt like a hunted fawn. Maud came out of the house as the car disappeared down the long avenue of elms. She crossed the terrace to where Reggie sat brooding on life and its problem.
"Reggie!"
Reggie turned.
"Hello, Maud, dear old thing. Take a seat."
Maud sat down beside him. There was a flush on her pretty face, and when she spoke, her voice quivered with suppressed excitement.
"Reggie," she said, laying a small hand on his arm. "We're friends, aren't we?"
Reggie patted her paternally. There were few people he liked better than Maud.
"'Always have been since the dear old days of childhood, what?'
"'I can trust you, can't I?'
"'Absolutely.'
"'There's something I want you to do for me, Reggie. "'You will have to keep it a dead secret, of course.'
"'The strong, silent man, that's me. What is it?'
"'You're driving into town in your car this afternoon, aren't you, to meet Percy?'
"'That was the idea.'
"'Could you go this morning instead, and take me?'
"'Of course.' Maud shook her head.
"'You don't know what you are letting yourself in for, Reggie, or I'm sure you would not agree so lightly. I'm not allowed to leave the castle, you know, because of what I was telling you about.'
"'The chappie?'
"'Yes. So there would be terrible scenes if anybody found out.'
"'Never mind, dear old soul. I'll risk it. None shall learn your secret from these lips.'
"'Oh, you're a darling, Reggie.'
"'But what's the idea? Why do you want to go today, particularly?'
Maud looked over her shoulder.
"'Because,' she lowered her voice, though there was no one near, "'because he is back in London. He is a sort of secretary, you know, Reggie, to his uncle, and I saw in the paper this morning that the uncle returned yesterday after a long voyage in his yacht. So he must have come back, too. He has to go everywhere his uncle goes.'
"'And everywhere the uncle went, the chappie was sure to go,' murmured Reggie. "'I'm sorry, didn't mean to interrupt.'
"'I must see him. I haven't seen him since last summer. Nearly a whole year. And he hasn't written to me, and I haven't dared to write to him, for fear of the letter going wrong. So, you see, I must go. Today is my only chance. Aunt Caroline has gone away. Father will be busy in the garden and won't notice whether I'm here or not. And besides, tomorrow it will be too late because Percy will be here. He was more furious about the thing than anyone.'
"'Rather the proud aristocrat, Percy,' agreed Reggie. "'I understand absolutely. Tell me just what you want me to do.'
"'I want you to pick me up in the car, about half a mile down the road. You can drop me off somewhere in Piccadilly. That will be near enough to where I want to go. But the most important thing is about Percy. You must persuade him to stay and dine in town and come back here after dinner. Then I shall be able to get back by an afternoon train, and no one will know I've been gone.'
"'That's simple enough, what? Consider it done. When do you want to start?'
"'At once.'
"'I'll toddle round to the garage and fetch the car,' Reggie chuckled amusedly. "'Rum thing. The mater's just been telling me I ought to take you out for a drive.'
"'You are a darling, Reggie, really.' Reggie gave her back another paternal pat.
"'I know what it means to be in love, dear old soul. I say, Maud, old thing, do you find love puts you off your stroke? What I mean is, does it make you slice your approach shots?'
Maud laughed. "'No, it hasn't had any effect on my game so far. I went round in 86 the other day.'
Reggie sighed enviously.
"'Women are wonderful,' he said.
"'Well, I'll be legging it and fetching the car. When you're ready, stroll along down the road and wait for me.'
When he had gone, Maud pulled a small newspaper clipping from her pocket. She had extracted it from yesterday's copy of the Morning Post's Society column. It contained only a few words. "'Mr. Wilbur Raymond has returned to his residence at No. 11A, Belgrave Square, from a prolonged voyage in his yacht, the Siren.' Maud did not know Mr. Wilbur Raymond, and yet that paragraph had sent the blood tingling through every vein in her body. For as she had indicated to Reggie, when the Wilbur Raymonds of this world return to their town residences, they bring with them their nephew and secretary, Geoffrey Raymond. And Geoffrey Raymond was the man Maud had loved ever since the day when she had met him in Wales. End of chapter 1.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse. Read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk. www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 2. The sun that had shone so brightly on Belpher Castle at noon when Maud and Reggie Byng set out on their journey shone on the west end of London with equal pleasantness at 2 o'clock. In Little Gooch Street, all the children of all the small shopkeepers who support life in that backwater by selling each other vegetables and singing canaries were out and about playing curious games of their own invention. Cats washed themselves on doorsteps preparatory to looking in for lunch at one of the numerous garbage cans which dotted the sidewalk. Waiters peered austerely from the windows of the two Italian restaurants, which carried on the Lucretta Borgia tradition by means of 1 shilling and 6 pence table d'hote luncheons. The proprietor of the grocery store in the corner was bidding a silent farewell to a tomato which even he, though a dauntless optimist, had been compelled to recognize as having outlived its utility. On all these things the sun shone with a genial smile. Around the corner, in Shaftesbury Avenue, an east wind was doing its best to pierce the hardened sides of the citizenry, but it did not penetrate into Little Gooch Street, which, facing south, and being narrow and sheltered, was enabled practically to bask. Mac, the stout guardian of the stage door of the Regal Theatre, whose gilded front entrance is on the avenue, emerged from the little glass case in which the management kept him, and came out to observe life and its phenomena with an indulgent eye. Mac was feeling happy this morning. His job was a permanent one, not influenced by the success or failure of the productions which followed one another at the theatre throughout the year, but he felt, nevertheless, a sort of proprietary interest in these ventures, and was pleased when they secured the approval of the public. Last night's opening, a musical piece by an American author and composer, had undoubtedly made a big hit, and Mac was glad because he liked what he had seen of the company, and, in the brief time in which he had known him, had come to entertain a warm regard for George Bevan, the composer, who had travelled over from New York to help with the London production. George Bevan turned the corner now, walking slowly, and it seemed to Mac, gloomily, towards the stage door. He was a young man of about 27, tall and well-knit, with an agreeable, clean-cut face, of which a pair of good and honest eyes were the most noticeable feature. His sensitive mouth was drawn down a little at the corners, and he looked tired. "Morning, Mac." "Good morning, sir." "Anything for me?" "Yes, sir, some telegrams. I'll get 'em." "Oh, I'll get 'em," said Mac, as if reassuring some doubting friend and supporter as to his ability to carry through a labour of Hercules. He disappeared into his glass case. George Bevan remained outside in the street, surveying the frisking children with a sombre glance. They seemed to him very noisy, very dirty, and very young. Disgustingly young. Theirs was joyous, exuberant youth, which made a fellow feel at least 60. Something was wrong with George today, for normally he was fond of children. Indeed, normally he was fond of most things. He was a good-natured and cheerful young man, who liked life and the great majority of those who lived it contemporaneously with himself. He had no enemies and many friends. But today he had noticed from the moment he had got out of bed that something was amiss with the world. Either he was in the grip of some divine discontent due to the highly developed condition of his soul, or else he had a grouch. One of the two. Or it might have been the reaction from the emotions of the previous night. On the morning after an opening, your sensitive artist is always apt to feel as if he had been dried over a barrel. Besides, last night there had been a supper party, after the performance, at the flat which the comedian of the troupe had rented in Jermyn Street. A forced, rowdy supper party, where a number of tired people with overstrained nerves had seemed to feel it a duty to be artificially vivacious. It had lasted till 4 o'clock, when the morning papers with the notices arrived, and George had not got to bed till 4:30. These things colour the mental outlook. Mac reappeared. "Here you are, sir." "Thanks." George put the telegrams in his pocket. A cat, on its way back from lunch, paused beside him in order to use his leg as a serviette. George tickled it under the ear abstractly. He was always courteous to cats, but today he went through the movements perfunctorily and without enthusiasm. The cat moved on. Mac became conversational. "They tell me the piece was a hit last night, sir." "It seemed to go very well." "My missus saw it from the gallery, and all the first-nighters were speaking very highly of it. There's a regular clique, you know, sir, over here in London that goes to all the first nights in the gallery. Highly critical they're always, especially if it's an American piece like this one. They don't like it, they precious well tell you so. My missus says they was all speaking very highly of it. My missus says she ain't seen a livelier show for a long time, and she's a great theatre-goer. My missus says they was all especially pleased with the music." "Well, that's good." "The morning leader give it a fine write-up. How was the rest of the papers? Splendid. All of them. I haven't seen the evening papers yet. I came out to get them. Mac looked down the street. There'll be a rehearsal this afternoon, I suppose, sir. Here's Miss Dore coming along. George followed his glance. A tall girl in a tailor-made suit of blue was coming towards them. Even at a distance, one caught the genial personality of the new arrival. It seemed to go before her like a heartening breeze. She picked her way carefully through the children crawling on the sidewalk. She stopped for a moment and said something to one of them. The child grinned. Even the proprietor of the grocery store appeared to brighten up at the sight of her, as at the sight of some old friend. "How's business, Bill?" she called to him as she passed the spot where he stood brooding on the mortality of tomatoes. And though he replied, "Rotten," a faint, grim smile did nevertheless flicker across his tragic mask. Billy Dore, who was one of the chorus of George Bevan's musical comedy, had an attractive face, a mouth that laughed readily, rather bright golden hair, which she was fond of insisting with perfect truth was genuine, though appearances were against it, and steady blue eyes. The latter was frequently employed by her in quelling admirers who were encouraged by the former to become too ardent. Billy's views on the opposite sex who forgot themselves were as rigid as those of Lord Marshmoreton concerning thrips. She liked men, and she would signify this liking in a practical manner by lunching and dining with them, but she was entirely self-supporting, and when men overlooked that fact, she reminded them of it in no uncertain voice, for she was a girl of ready speech and direct. "Morning, George. Morning, Mac. Any mail?" "I'll see, miss." "How did your better 4/5 like the show, Mac?" "I was just telling Mr. Bevan, miss, that the missus said she hadn't seen a livelier show for a long time." "Fine. I knew I'd be a hit. Well, George, how's the boy this bright afternoon?" "Limp and pessimistic." "Well, that comes of sitting up till 4 in the morning with festive hams. You were up as late as I was, and you look like little Eva after a night of sweet, childish slumber." "Yes, but I drank ginger ale and didn't smoke 18 cigars. And yet I don't know. I think I must be getting old, George. All-night parties seem to have lost their charm. I was ready to quit at 1 o'clock, but it didn't seem matey. I think I'll marry a farmer and settle down." George was amazed. He had not expected to find his present view of life shared in this quarter. "I was just thinking myself," he said, feeling not for the first time how different Billy was from the majority of those with whom his profession brought him in contact. "How flat it all was. The show business, I mean. And these darn first nights and all the party after the show, which you can't sidestep. Something tells me I'm about through." Billy Dore nodded. "Anybody with any sense is always about through with the show business. I know I am. If you think I'm wedded to my art, let me tell you, I am going to get a divorce the first chance that comes along. It's funny about the show business, the way one drifts into it and sticks. I mean, take me, for example. Nature had it all doped out for me to be the belle of Hicks Corners. What I ought to have done was to buy a gingham bonnet and milk cows. But I would come to the great city and help brighten up the tired businessman." "I didn't know you were fond of the country, Billy." "Me? I wrote the words and music. Didn't you know I was a country kid? My dad ran a bide-a-wee home for flowers, and I used to know them all by their middle names. He was a nursery gardener out in Indiana. I tell you, when I see a rose nowadays, I shake its hand and say, 'Well, well, Cyril, how's everything with you? And how are Joe and Jack and Jimmy and all the rest of the boys at home?' Do you know how I used to put in my time the first few nights I was over there in London? I used to hang around Covent Garden with my head back, sniffing. The boys that mess about with the flowers there used to stub their toes on me so often that they got to look on me as part of the scenery. That's where we ought to have been last night. We'd have had a better time. Say, George, did you see that awful mistake on Nature's part that Babe Sinclair showed up with towards the middle of the proceedings? You must have noticed him, because he took up more room than any one man is entitled to. His name was Spencer Gray." George recalled having been introduced to a fat man of his own age who answered to that name. "It's a darned shame," said Billy indignantly. "Babe is only a kid. This is the first show she's been in, and I happen to know there's an awfully nice boy over in New York crazy to marry her, and I'm certain this gink is giving her a raw deal. He tried to get a hold of me about a week ago, but I turned him down hard, and I suppose he thinks Babe is easier. And it's no good talking to her. She thinks he's wonderful. That's another kick I have against the show business. It seems to make girls such darn chumps. Well, I wonder how much longer Mr. Arbuckle is going to be retrieving my mail. What ho within there? Fatty!" Mac came out, apologetic, carrying letters. "Sorry, miss. By an oversight, I put you among the G's." "All's well that ends well. Put me among the G's. There's a good title for a song for you, George. Excuse me while I grapple with the correspondence. I'll bet half of these are mash notes. I got three between the first and second acts last night. Why the nobility and gentry of this burg should think that I am their affinity just because I've got golden hair, which is perfectly genuine, Mac, I can show you the pedigree, and because I earn an honest living singing off-key is more than I can understand. Mac leaned his massive shoulders comfortably against the building and resumed his chat. I expect you're feeling very happy today, sir. George pondered. He was certainly feeling better since he had seen Billy Dore, but he was far from being himself. I ought to be, I suppose, but I'm not. Ah, you're getting blasty, sir. That's what it is. You've had too much of the fat, you have. This piece was a big hit in America, wasn't it? Yes, it ran over a year in New York, and there are three companies of it now. That's how it is, you see. You've gone and got blasty. Too big a helping of success you've had. Mac wagged his head like a harvest moon. You aren't a married man, are you, sir? Billy Dore finished skimming through her mail and crumpled the letters up into a large ball, which she handed to Mac. Here's something for you to read in your spare moments, Mac. Glance through them any time you have a suspicion you may be a chump, and you'll have the comfort of knowing that there are others. What were you saying about being married? Mr. Bevan and I was having a talk about him being blarsy, miss. Are you blarsy, George? So Mac says. And why is he blarsy, miss? Demanded Mac rhetorically. Well, don't ask me, said Billy. It's not my fault. It's because, as I was saying, he's had too big an helping of success, and because he ain't a married man. You did say you wasn't a married man, didn't you, sir? I didn't, but I'm not. That's how it is, you see. You pretty soon get sick of pulling off good things if you ain't got nobody to pat you on the back for doing it. Why, when I was single, if I got hold of a sure thing for a 3 o'clock race and picked up a couple of quid, the thrill of it didn't seem to linger somehow. But now, if some of the gentlemen that come here put me on to something safe and I make a bit off the fascination of it, taking the stuff home and rolling it on the kitchen table and having her pat me on the back. You seem to understand the art of being happy, Mac. It ain't an art, sir. It's just getting hold of the right little woman and having a nice little home of your own to go back to at night. Mac, said Billy admiringly, you talk like a Tin Pan Alley song hit, except that you've left out the scent of honeysuckle and old Mr. Moon climbing up over the trees. Well, you're quite right. I'm all for the simple and domestic life. If I could find the right, and he didn't see me coming and duck, I'd become one of the Mendelssohn's March daughters right away. Are you going, George? There's a rehearsal at 2:30 for cuts. I want to get the evening papers and send off a cable or two. See you later. We shall meet at Philippi. Mac eyed George's retreating back till he had turned the corner. Nice, pleasant gentleman, Mr. Bevan, he said. Too bad he's got the pip the way he has, just after having a big success like this here. Comes of being an artist, I suppose. Miss Dore dived into her vanity case and produced a puff with which she proceeded to powder her nose. All composers are nuts, Mac. I was in a show once where the manager was panning the composer because there wasn't a number in the score that had a tune to it. Well, the poor geek admitted they weren't very toony, but he said the thing about his music was that it had such a wonderful aroma. They all get that way. The jazz seems to go to their heads. George is all right, though, and don't let anyone tell you different. How long have you known him, miss? About 5 years. I was a stenographer in the house that published his songs when I first met him. And there's another thing you've got to hand it to George for. He hasn't let success give him a swelled head. The money that boy makes is sinful, Mac. He wears $1,000 bills next to his skin winter and summer, but he's just the same as he was when I first knew him, when he was just hanging around Broadway, looking out for a chance to be allowed to slip a couple of interpolated numbers into any old show that came along. Yes, put it in your diary, Mac, and write it on your cuff. George Bevan's all right. He's an ace. Unconscious of these eulogies, which, coming from one whose judgment he respected, might have cheered him up, George wandered down Shaftesbury Avenue, feeling more depressed than ever. The sun had gone in for the time being, and the east wind was frolicking around him like a playful puppy, patting him with a cold paw, nuzzling his ankles, bounding away and bounding back again, and behaving generally as east winds do when they discover a victim who has come out without his spring overcoat. It was plain to George now that the sun and the wind were a couple of confidence tricksters working together as a team. The sun had disarmed him with specious promises and an air of cheery good fellowship, and had delivered him into the hands of the wind, which was now going through him with the swift thoroughness of the professional hold-up artist. He quickened his steps and began to wonder if he was so sunk in senile decay as to have acquired a liver. He discarded the theory as repellent, and yet there must be a reason for his depression. Today, of all days, as Mac had pointed out, he had everything to make him happy. Popular as he was in America, this was the first piece of his to be produced in London, and there was no doubt that it was a success of unusual dimensions. And yet he felt no elation. He reached Piccadilly and turned westwards, and then, as he passed the gates of the In-and-Out Club, he had a moment of clear vision and understood everything. He was depressed because he was bored, and he was bored because he was lonely. Mac, that solid thinker, had been right. The solution of the problem of life was to get hold of the right girl and have a home to go back to at night. He was mildly surprised that he had tried in any other direction for an explanation of his gloom. It was all the more inexplicable in that fully 80% of the lyrics which he had set in the course of his musical comedy career had had that thought at the back of them. George gave himself up to an orgy of sentimentality. He seemed to be alone in the world, which had paired itself off into a sort of seething welter of happy couples. Taxicabs full of happy couples rolled by every minute. Passing omnibuses creaked beneath the weight of happy couples. The very policeman across the street had just grinned at a flitting shopgirl, and she had smiled back at him. The only female in London who did not appear to be attached was a girl in brown who was coming along the sidewalk at a leisurely pace, looking about her in a manner that suggested that she found Piccadilly a new and stimulating spectacle. As far as George could see, she was an extremely pretty girl, small and dainty, with a proud little tilt to her head, and a jaunty walk that spoke of perfect health. She was, in fact, precisely the sort of girl that George felt he could love with all the stored-up devotion of an old buffer of 27, who had squandered none of his rich nature in foolish flirtations. He had just begun to weave a rose-tinted romance with their two selves when a cold reaction set in. Even as he paused to watch the girl threading her way through the crowd, the east wind jabbed an icy finger down the back of his neck, and the chill of it sobered him. After all, he reflected bitterly, this girl was only alone because she was on her way somewhere to meet some confounded man. Besides, there was no earthly chance of getting to know her. You can't rush up to pretty girls in the street and tell them you are lonely. At least you can, but it doesn't get you anywhere except the police station. George's gloom deepened, a thing he would not have believed possible a moment before. He felt that he had been born too late. The restraints of modern civilization irked him. It was not, he told himself, like this in the good old days. In medieval ages, for example, this girl would have been a damsel, and in that happy time practically everybody whose technical rating was that of damsel was in distress and only too willing to waive the formalities in return for services rendered by the casual passer-by. But the 20th century was a prosaic age when girls are merely girls and have no troubles at all. Were he to stop this girl in brown and assure her that his aid and comfort were at her disposal? She would undoubtedly call that large policeman from across the way, and the romance would begin and end within the space of 30 seconds. Or, if the policeman were a quick mover, rather less. Better to dismiss dreams and return to the practical side of life by buying the evening papers from the shabby individual beside him, who had just thrust an early edition into his face. After all, notices are notices, even when the heart is aching. George felt in his pocket for the necessary money, found emptiness, and remembered that he had left all his ready funds at his hotel. It was just one of the things he might have expected on a day like this. The man with the papers had the air of one whose business is conducted on purely cash principles. There was only one thing to be done: return to the hotel, retrieve his money, and try to forget the weight of the world and its cares in lunch. And from the hotel he could dispatch the two or three cables which he wanted to send to New York. The girl in brown was quite close now, and George was enabled to get a clearer glimpse of her. She more than fulfilled the promise she had given him at a distance. Had she been constructed to his own specifications, she would not have been more acceptable in George's sight. And now she was going out of his life forever. With an overwhelming sense of pathos, for there is no pathos more bitter than that of parting from someone we have never met, George hailed a taxicab which crawled to the side of the road, and, with all the refrains of all the sentimental song hits he had ever composed ringing in his ears, he got in and passed away. A rotten world, he mused as the cab, after proceeding a couple of yards, came to a standstill in a block of traffic. A dull, flat bore of a world in which nothing happens or ever will happen. Even when you take a cab, it just sticks and doesn't move. At this point, the door of the cab opened, and the girl in brown jumped in. "I am so sorry," she said breathlessly, "but would you mind hiding me, please?" End of chapter 2.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Yas Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Woodhouse.
Chapter 3. George hid her. He did it, too, without wasting precious time by asking questions. In a situation which might well have thrown the quickest-witted of men off his balance, he acted with promptitude, intelligence, and dispatch. The fact is, George had for years been an assiduous golfer, and there is no finer school for teaching concentration and a strict attention to the matter in hand. Few crises, however unexpected, have the power to disturb a man who has so conquered the weakness of the flesh as to have trained himself to bend his left knee, raise his left heel, swing his arms well out from the body, twist himself into the shape of a corkscrew, and use the muscle of his wrist, at the same time keeping his head still and his eye on the ball. It is estimated that there are 23 important points to be borne in mind simultaneously while making a drive at golf, and to the man who has mastered the art of remembering them all, the task of hiding girls in taxicabs is a mere child's play. To pull down the blinds on the side of the vehicle nearest the curb was, with George, the work of a moment. Then he leaned out of the center window in such manner as completely to screen the interior of the cab from public view. "Thank you so much," murmured a voice behind him. It seemed to come from the floor.
"Not at all," said George,
trying a sort of vocal chip-shot out of the corner of his mouth, designed to lift his voice backwards and lay it dead inside the cab. He gazed upon Piccadilly with eyes from which the scales had fallen. Reason told him that he was still in Piccadilly. Otherwise, it would have seemed incredible to him that this could be the same street which a moment before he had passed judgment upon and found flat and uninteresting. True, in its salient features, it had altered little. The same number of stodgy-looking people moved up and down. The buildings retained the air of not having had a bath since the days of the Tudors. The east wind still blew. But, though superficially the same, in reality, Piccadilly had altered completely. Before, it had been just Piccadilly. Now it was a golden street in the city of romance, a main thoroughfare of Baghdad, one of the principal arteries of the capital of Fairyland. A rose-coloured mist swam before George's eyes. His spirits, so low but a few moments back, soared like a good niblick shot out of the bunker of gloom. The years fell away from him till, in an instant, from being a rather poorly preserved, liverish greybeard of 65 or so, he became a sprightly lad of 21, in a world of springtime and flowers and laughing brooks. In other words, taking it by and large, George felt pretty good. The impossible had happened. Heaven had sent him an adventure, and he didn't care if it snowed. It was possibly the rose-coloured mist before his eyes that prevented him from observing the hurried approach of a faultlessly attired young man, aged about 21, who, during George's preparations for ensuring privacy in his cab, had been galloping in pursuit in a resolute manner that suggested a well-dressed bloodhound, somewhat overfed and out of condition. Only when this person stopped and began to pant within a few inches of his face did he become aware of his existence.
"You, sir," said the bloodhound, removing a gleaming silk hat, mopping a pink forehead and replacing the luminous superstructure once more in position. "You, sir."
Whatever may be said of the possibility of love at first sight, in which theory George was now a confirmed believer, there can be no doubt that an exactly opposite phenomenon is of frequent occurrence. After one look at some people, even friendship is impossible. Such a one, in George's opinion, was this gurgling excrescence underneath the silk hat. He comprised, in his single person, practically all the qualities which George disliked most. He was, for a young man, extraordinarily obese. Already a second edition of his chin had been published, and the perfectly cut morning coat which encased his upper section bulged out in an opulent semicircle. He wore a little moustache, which to George's prejudiced eye seemed more a complaint than a moustache. His face was red, his manner dictatorial, and he was touched in the wind. To Take him for all in all, he looked like a bit of bad news. George had been educated at Lawrenceville and Harvard, and had subsequently had the privilege of mixing socially with many of New York's most prominent theatrical managers, so he knew how to behave himself. No Vere de Vere could have exhibited greater repose of manner. "And what," he inquired suavely, leaning a little further out of the cab, "is eating you, Bill?" A messenger boy, two shabby men engaged in non-essential industries, and a shop girl paused to observe the scene. Time was not of the essence to these confirmed sightseers. The shop girl was late already, so it didn't matter if she was any later. The messenger boy had nothing on hand except a message marked "Important Rush," and as for the two shabby men, their only immediate plans consisted of a vague intention of getting to some public house and leaning against the wall, so George's time was their time. One of the pair put his head on one side and said, "What ho?" The other picked up a cigar stub from the gutter and began to smoke.
"A young lady just got into your cab," said the stout young man.
"Surely not," said George.
"What the devil do you mean, surely not?"
"I've been in the cab all the time, and I should have noticed it." At this juncture the block in the traffic was relieved, and the cab bowled smartly on for some 50 yards, when it was again halted. George, protruding from the window like a snail, was entertained by the spectacle of the pursuit. The hunt was up. Short of throwing his head up and baying, the stout young man behaved exactly as a bloodhound in similar circumstances would have conducted itself. He broke into a jerky gallop, attended by his self-appointed associates, and, considering that the young man was so stout, that the messenger boy considered it unprofessional to hurry, that the shop girl had doubts as to whether sprinting was quite ladylike, and that the two bohemians were moving at a quicker gait than a shuffle for the first occasion in 11 years, the cavalcade made good time. The cab was still stationary when they arrived in a body.
"Here he is, guv'nor," said the messenger boy, removing a bead of perspiration with a rush message.
"Here he is, guv'nor," said the non-smoking bohemian. "What ho!"
"Here I am," agreed George affably. "And what can I do for you?" The smoker spat appreciatively at a passing dog. The point seemed to him well taken. Not for many a day had he so enjoyed himself. In an arid world containing too few goes of gin and too many policemen, a world in which the poor were oppressed and could seldom even enjoy a quiet cigar without having their fingers trodden upon, he found himself for the moment contented, happy, and expectant. This looked like a row between toffs, and of all things which most intrigued him, a row between toffs ranked highest.
"Ah," he said approvingly, "now you're talking."
The shop girl had espied an acquaintance in the crowd. She gave tongue.
"Maudie! Come here quick, something's happening."
Maudie, accompanied by perhaps a dozen more of London's millions, added herself to the audience. These all belong to the class which will gather round and watch silently while a motorist mends a tire. They are not impatient. They do not call for rapid and continuous action. A mere hole in the ground, which of all sights is perhaps the least vivid and dramatic, is enough to grip their attention for hours at a time. They stared at George and George's cab with unblinking gaze. They did not know what would happen or when it would happen, but they intended to wait till something did happen. It might be for years, or it might be forever, but they meant to be there when things began to occur. Speculations became audible.
"What is it? An accident?"
"Nah. Gents had his pocket picked."
"Two toffs had a scrap." "Feller bilked the cabman."
A sceptic made a cynical suggestion.
"They're doing it for the pictures."
The idea gained instant popularity.
"Gee, that? It's a film." "What ho, Charlie?" "The camera's hidden in the cab."
"What'll they be up to next?"
A red-nosed spectator with a tray of collar studs harnessed to his stomach started another school of thought. He spoke with decision as one having authority.
"Nothing of the blinking kind.
The fat un's been having one or two round the corner, and it's gone and got into his head."
The driver of the cab, who, till now, had been ostentatiously unaware that there was any sort of disturbance among the lower orders, suddenly became humanly inquisitive.
"What's it all about?" he asked, swinging round and addressing George's head.
"Exactly what I want to know," said George.
He indicated the collar-stud merchant.
"The gentleman over there with the portable Woolworth bargain counter seems to me to have the best theory."
The stout young man, whose peculiar behaviour had drawn all this flattering attention from the many-headed, and who appeared considerably ruffled by the publicity, had been puffing noisily during the foregoing conversation. Now, having recovered sufficient breath to resume the attack, he addressed himself to George once more.
"Damn you, sir! Will you let me look inside that cab?"
"Leave me," said George. "I would be alone."
"There is a young lady in that cab. I saw her get in, and I have been watching ever since, and she has not got out, so she is there now."
George nodded approval of this close reasoning. "Your argument seems to be without a flaw. But what then? We applaud the man of logic, but what of the man of action? What are you going to do about it?"
"Get out of my way!"
"I won't."
"Then I'll force my way in."
"If you try it, I shall infallibly bust you one on the jaw." The stout young man drew back a pace.
"You can't do that sort of thing, you know."
"I know I can't," said George, "but I shall. In this life, my dear sir, we must be prepared for every emergency. We must distinguish between the unusual and the impossible. It would be unusual for a comparative stranger to lean out of a cab window and sock you one. But you appear to have laid your plans on the assumption that it would be impossible. Let this be a lesson to you."
"I tell you what it is."
"The advice I give to every young man starting life is, never confuse the unusual with the impossible. Take the present case, for instance. If you had only realized the possibility of somebody some day busting you one on the jaw when you tried to get into a cab, you might have thought out dozens of crafty schemes for dealing with the matter. As it is, you are unprepared. The thing comes on you as a surprise. The whisper flies around the clubs. Poor old what's-his-name has been taken unawares. He cannot cope with the situation." The man with the collar studs made another diagnosis. He was seeing clearer and clearer into the thing every minute.
"Loony," he decided. "This here one's been mopping of it up, and the one in the cab's off his bloomin' onion. That's why he's standin' up instead of settin'. He won't set down, except you bring him a bit of toast, 'cause he thinks he's a poached egg."
George beamed upon the intelligent fellow. "Your reasoning is admirable, but—" He broke off here, not because he had not more to say, but for the reason that the stout young man, now in quite a berserk frame of mind, had made a sudden spring at the cab door and clutched the handle, which he was about to wrench when George acted with all the promptitude and decision which had marked his behaviour from the start. It was a situation which called for the nicest judgment. To allow the assailant free play with the handle, or even to wrestle with him for its possession, entailed the risk that the door might open and reveal the girl. To bust the young man on the jaw, as promised, on the other hand, was not in George's eyes a practical policy. Excellent a deterrent as the threat of such a proceeding might be, its actual accomplishment was not to be thought of. Jails yawn, and actions for assault lie in wait for those who go about the place busting their fellows on the jaw. No, something swift, something decided and immediate was indicated, but something that stopped short of technical battery. George brought his hand round with a sweep, and knocked the stout young man's silk hat off. The effect was magical. We all of us have our Achilles heel. And paradoxically enough, in the case of the stout young man, that heel was his hat. Superbly built by the only hatter in London who can construct a silk hat that is a silk hat, and freshly ironed by loving hands but a brief hour before at the only shaving parlour in London where ironing is ironing, and not a brutal attack, it was his pride and joy. To lose it was like losing his trousers. It made him feel insufficiently clad. With a passionate cry like that of some wild creature deprived of its young, the erstwhile berserk released the handle and sprang in pursuit. At the same moment, the traffic moved on again. The last George saw was a group scene, with a stout young man in the middle of it. The hat had been popped up into the infield, where it had been caught by the messenger boy. The stout young man was bending over it and stroking it with soothing fingers. It was too far off for anything to be audible, but he seemed to George to be murmuring words of endearment to it. Then, placing it on his head, he darted out into the road, and George saw him no more. The audience remained motionless, staring at the spot where the incident had happened. They would continue to do this till the next policeman came along and moved them on. With a pleasant wave of farewell, in case any of them might be glancing in his direction, George drew in his body and sat down. The girl in brown had risen from the floor, if she had ever been there, and was now seated composedly at the further end of the cab. End of chapter 3.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse. Read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk. www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 4. "Well, that's that," said George. "I'm so much obliged to you," said the girl. "It was a pleasure," said George. He was enabled now to get a closer, more leisurely, and much more satisfactory view of this distressed damsel that had been his good fortune up to the present. Small details which, when he had first caught sight of her, distance had hidden from his view, now presented themselves. Her eyes, he discovered, which he had supposed brown, were only brown in their general colour scheme. They were shot with attractive little flecks of gold, matching perfectly the little streaks of gold which the sun, coming out again on one of his flying visits and now shining benignantly once more on the world, revealed in her hair. Her chin was square and determined, but its resoluteness was contradicted by a dimple and by the pleasant good humour of the mouth, and a further softening of the face was effected by the nose, which seemed to have started out with the intention of being dignified and aristocratic, but had defeated its purpose by tilting very slightly at the tip. This was a girl who would take chances, but would take them with a smile and a laugh when she lost. George was but an amateur physiognomist, but he could read what was obvious in the faces he encountered, and the more he looked at this girl, the less he was able to understand the scene which had just occurred. The thing mystified him completely. For all her good humour, there was an air, a manner, a something capable and defensive about this girl with which he could not imagine any man venturing to take liberties. The gold-brown eyes, as they met his now, were friendly and smiling, but he could imagine them freezing into a stare baleful enough and haughty enough to quell such a person as the silk-hatted young man with a single glance. Why, then, had that super-fatted individual been able to demoralize her to the extent of flying to the shelter of strange cabs? She was composed enough now, it was true, but it had been quite plain at the moment when she entered the taxi her nerve had momentarily forsaken her. There were mysteries here beyond George. The girl looked steadily at George, and George looked steadily at her for the space of perhaps 10 seconds. She seemed to George to be summing him up, weighing him. That the inspection proved satisfactory was shown by the fact that at the end of this period she smiled. Then she laughed, a clear, pealing laugh which to George was far more musical than the most popular song-hit he had ever written. "I suppose you are wondering what this is all about," she said. This was precisely what George was wondering most consumedly. "No, no," he said, "not at all. It's not my business. And of course you are much too well-bred to be inquisitive about other people's business." "Of course I am. What was it all about?" "I'm afraid I can't tell you. What am I to say to the cabman?" "I don't know. What do men usually say to cabmen?" "I mean, he will feel very hurt if I don't give him a full explanation of all this. He stooped from his pedestal to make inquiries just now. Condescension like that deserves some recognition."
"Give him a nice big tip."
George was reminded of his reason for being in the cab.
I ought to have asked before. He said, "Where can I drive you?" "Oh, I mustn't steal your cab. Where were you going?" "I was going back to my hotel. I came out without any money, so I shall have to go back there first to get some." The girl started. "What's the matter?" asked George. "I've lost my purse." "Good Lord, had it much in it?" "Well, not very much, but enough to buy a ticket home." "Any use asking where that is?" "None, I'm afraid. I wasn't going to, of course." "Of course not. That's what I admire so much in you. You aren't inquisitive." George reflected. "There's only one thing to be done. You'll have to wait in the cab at the hotel while I go and get some money. And then, if you'll let me, I can lend you what you require." "It's much too kind of you. Could you manage 11 shillings? "Easily. I've just had a legacy. Of course, if you think I ought to be economical, I'll go third class. That would be only 5 shillings. 10 and 6 is the first class fare. So, you see, the place I want to get to is 2 hours from London." "Well, that's something to know. But not much, is it?" "I think I had better lend you a sovereign. Then you'll be able to buy a lunch basket."
"You think of everything. And you're perfectly right. I shall be starving. But how do you know you will get the money back?"
"I'll risk it." "Well, then, I shall have to be inquisitive and ask your name. Otherwise, I shan't know where to send the money." "Oh, there's no mystery about me. I'm an open book."
"You needn't be horrid about it. I can't help being mysterious."
"I didn't mean that. It sounded as if you did.
Well, who is my benefactor?"
"My name is George Bevan. I'm staying at the Carlton at present."
"I'll remember."
The taxi moved slowly down the Haymarket. The girl laughed. "Yes," said George. "I was only thinking of back there. You know, I haven't thanked you nearly enough for all you did. You were wonderful."
"Well, I'm very glad I was able to be of any help."
"What did happen? You must remember I couldn't see a thing except your back, and I could hear only indistinctly."
"Well, it started by a man galloping up and insisting that you had got into the cab. He was a fellow with the appearance of a before-using advertisement of an anti-fat medicine and the manners of a ring-tailed chimpanzee." The girl nodded. "Then it was Percy. I knew I wasn't mistaken."
"Percy?"
"That is his name."
"It would be. I could have betted on it."
"What happened then?"
"I reasoned with the man, but didn't seem to soothe him, and finally he made a grab for the door handle. So I knocked off his hat, and while he was retrieving it, we moved on and escaped." The girl gave another silver peal of laughter.
"Oh, what a shame I couldn't see it! But how resourceful of you! How did you happen to think of it?"
"It just came to me," said George modestly. A serious look came into the girl's face. The smile died out of her eyes. She shivered.
"But I think how some men might have behaved in your place."
"Oh, no, any man would have done just what I did. Surely knocking off Percy's hat was an act of simple courtesy which anyone would have performed automatically."
"We might have been some awful bounder. Or what would have been worse, a slow-witted idiot who would have stopped to ask questions before doing anything. To think I should have had the luck to pick you out of all of London."
"I've been looking on it as a piece of luck, but entirely from my viewpoint." She put a small hand on his arm and spoke earnestly.
"Mr. Bevan, you mustn't think that because I've been laughing a good deal and have seemed to treat all this as a joke, you haven't saved me from real trouble. If you hadn't been there and hadn't acted with such presence of mind, it would have been terrible."
"Oh, but surely if that fellow was annoying you, you could have called a policeman."
"Oh, it wasn't anything like that. It was much, much worse. But I mustn't go on like this. It isn't fair on you."
Her eyes lit up again with the old shining smile. "I know you have no curiosity about me, but still there is no knowing whether I might not arouse him if I went on piling up the mystery. And the silly part is that really there's no mystery at all. It's just that I can't tell anyone about it."
"That very fact seems to me to constitute the making of a pretty fair mystery."
"Well, what I mean is, I'm not a princess in disguise trying to escape from anarchists, or anything like those things you read about in books. I'm just in a perfectly simple piece of trouble. You would be bored to death if I told you about it."
"Try me."
She shook her head.
"No. Besides, here we are."
The cab had stopped at the hotel, and a commissionaire was already opening the door.
"Now, if you haven't repented of your rash offer, and really are going to be so awfully kind as to let me have that money, would you mind rushing off and getting it? Because I must hurry. I can just catch a good train, and it's hours to the next."
"Will you wait here? I'll be back in a moment."
"Very well."
The last George saw of her was another of those exhilarating smiles of hers. It was literally the last he saw of her, for when he returned, not more than 2 minutes later, the cab had gone, the girl had gone, and the world was empty. To him, gaping at this wholly unforeseen calamity, the commissionaire vouchsafed information. "Young lady took the cab on, sir."
the cab on. Almost immediately after you had gone, sir, she got in again and told the man to drive to Waterloo." George could make nothing of it. He stood there in silent perplexity, and might have continued to stand indefinitely had not his mind been distracted by a dictatorial voice at his elbow. "You, sir, damn it!" A second taxicab had pulled up, and from it a stout, scarlet-faced man had sprung. One glance told George all. The hunt was up once more. The bloodhound had picked up the trail. Percy was in again. For the first time since he had become aware of her flight, George was thankful that the girl had disappeared. He perceived that he had too quickly eliminated Percy from the list of things that matter. Engrossed with his own affairs, and having regarded their late skirmish as a decisive battle from which there could be no rallying, he had overlooked the possibility of this annoying and unnecessary person following them in another cab, a task which, in the congested, slow-moving traffic, must have been a perfectly simple one. Well, here he was, his soul manifestly all stirred up, and his blood pressure at a far higher figure than his doctor would have approved of, and the matter would have to be opened all over again. "Now then," said the young man. George regarded him with a critical and unfriendly eye. He disliked this fatty degeneration excessively. Looking him up and down, he could find no point about him that gave him the least pleasure, with the single exception of the state of his hat, in the side of which he rejoiced to perceive there was a large and unshapely dent. "You thought you had shaken me off. You thought you'd given me the slip. Well, you're wrong!" George eyed him coldly. "I know what's the matter with you," he said. "Someone's been feeding you meat." The young man bubbled with fury. His face turned a deeper scarlet. He gesticulated, "You blackguard! Where is my sister?" At this extraordinary remark, the world rocked about George dizzily. The words upset his entire diagnosis of the situation. Until that moment, he had looked upon this man as a Lothario, a pursuer of damsels. That the other could possibly have any right on his side had never occurred to him. He felt unmanned by the shock. It seemed to cut the ground from under his feet. "Your sister? You heard what I said. Where is she?" George was still endeavouring to adjust his scattered faculties. He felt foolish and apologetic. He had imagined himself unassailably in the right, and it now appeared that he was in the wrong. For a moment he was about to become conciliatory. Then the recollection of the girl's panic and her hints at some trouble which threatened her, presumably through the medium of this man, brother or no brother, checked him. He did not know what it was all about, but the one thing that did stand out clearly in that welter of confused happenings was the girl's need for his assistance, whatever might be the rights of the case. He was her accomplice, and must behave as such. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. The young man shook a large gloved fist in his face. "You blackguard!" A rich, deep, soft, soothing voice slid into the heated scene like the Holy Grail sliding athwart a sunbeam. "What's all this?" A vast policeman had materialized from nowhere. He stood beside them, a living statue of vigilant authority. One thumb rested easily on his broad belt. The fingers of the other hand caressed lightly a moustache that had caused more heart-burnings among the gentler sex than any other two moustaches in the C division. The eyes above the moustache were stern and questioning. "What's all this?" George liked policemen. He knew the way to treat them. His voice, when he replied, had precisely the correct note of respectful deference which the force likes to hear. "I really couldn't say, officer," he said, with just that air of having, in a time of trouble, found a kind elder brother to help him out of his difficulties, which made the constable his ally on the spot. "I was standing here when this man suddenly made his extraordinary attack on me. I wish you would ask him to go away." The policeman tapped the stout young man on the shoulder. "This won't do, you know," he said austerely. "This sort of thing won't do here, you know." "Take your hands off me," snorted Percy. A frown appeared on the Olympian brow. Jove reached for his thunderbolts. "Hello, hello, hello," he said in a shocked voice, as of a god defied by a mortal. "Hello, hello, hello." His fingers fell on Percy's shoulder again, but this time not in a mere warning tap. They rested where they fell, in an iron clutch. "It won't do, you know," he said. "This sort of thing won't do." Madness came upon the stout young man. Common prudence and the lessons of a carefully taught youth fell from him like a garment. With an incoherent howl, he wriggled round and punched the policeman smartly in the stomach. "Halt!" quoth the outraged officer, suddenly becoming human. His left hand removed itself from the belt, and he got a businesslike grip on his adversary's collar. "Will you come along with me?" It was amazing. The thing had happened in such an incredibly brief space of time. One moment, it seemed to George, he was the centre of a nasty row in one of the most public spots in London. The next, the focus had shifted. He had ceased to matter, and the entire attention of the metropolis was focused on his late assailant, as, urged by the arm of the law, he made that journey to Vine Street police station which so many a better man than he had trod. George watched the pair as they moved up the Haymarket, followed by a growing and increasingly absorbed crowd. Then he turned into the hotel. "This," he said to himself, "is the middle of a perfect day, and I thought London dull." End of chapter 4.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Yas Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Woodhouse. Chapter 5. George awoke next morning with a misty sense that somehow the world had changed. As the last remnants of sleep left him, he was aware of a vague excitement. Then he sat up in bed with a jerk. He had remembered that he was in love. There was no doubt about it. A curious happiness pervaded his entire being. He felt young and active. Everything was emphatically for the best, in the best of all possible worlds. The sun was shining. Even the sound of someone in the street below whistling one of his old compositions, of which he had heartily sickened 12 months before, was pleasant to his ears. And this, in spite of the fact that the unseen whistler only touched the key in odd spots, and had a poor memory for tunes. George sprang lightly out of bed, and turned on the cold tap in the bathroom. While he lathered his face for his morning shave, he beamed at himself in the mirror. It had come at last, the real thing. George had never been in love before, not really in love. True, from the age of 15 he had been in varying degrees of intensity attracted sentimentally by the opposite sex. Indeed, at that period of life of which Mr. Booth Tarkington has written so searchingly, the age of 17, he had been in love with practically every female he had met, and with dozens whom he had only seen in the distance. But ripening years had mellowed his taste and robbed him of that fine romantic catholicity. During the last 5 years women had found him more or less cold. It was the nature of his profession that had largely brought about this cooling of the emotions. To a man who, like George, has worked year in and year out at the composition of musical comedies, woman comes to lose many of those attractive qualities which ensnare the ordinary male. To George, of late years, it had begun to seem that the salient features of a woman as a sex was her disposition to kick. For 5 years he had been wandering in a world of women, many of them beautiful, all of them superficially attractive, who had left no other impress on his memory except the vigor and frequency with which they kicked. Some had kicked about their musical numbers, some about their love scenes, some had grumbled about their exit lines, others about the lines of their second act frocks. They had kicked in a myriad differing ways, wrathfully, sweetly, noisily, softly, smilingly, tearfully, pathetically, and patronizingly. But they had all kicked, with the result that woman had now become to George not so much a flaming inspiration or a tender goddess, as something to be dodged, tactfully if possible, but, if not possible, by open flight. For years he had dreaded to be left alone with a woman, and had developed a habit of gliding swiftly away when he saw one bearing down on him. The psychological effect of such a state of things is not difficult to realize. Take a man of naturally quixotic temperament, a man of chivalrous instincts, and a feeling for romance, and cut him off for 5 years from the exercise of those qualities, and you get an accumulated store of foolishness only comparable to an escape of gas in a sealed room or a cellarful of dynamite. A flicker of a match, and there is an explosion. This girl's tempestuous eruption into his life had supplied flame for George. Her bright eyes, looking into his, had touched off the spiritual trinitrolule which he had been storing up for so long. Up in the air in a million pieces had gone the prudence and self-restraint of a lifetime. And here he was, as desperately in love as any troubadour of the Middle Ages. It was not till he had finished shaving and was testing the temperature of his bath with a shrinking toe that the realization came over him in a wave that, though he may be in love, the fairway of love was dotted with more bunkers than any golf course he had ever played on in his life. In the first place, he did not know the girl's name. In the second place, it seemed practically impossible that he would ever see her again. Even in the midst of his optimism, George could not deny that these facts might reasonably be considered in the nature of obstacles. He went back into his bedroom and sat on his bed. This thing wanted thinking over. He was not depressed, only a little thoughtful. His faith in his luck sustained him. He was, he realized, in the position of a man who has made a supreme drive from the tee and finds his ball near the green but in a cuppy lie. He had gained much. It now remained for him to push his success to the happy conclusion. The driver of luck must be replaced by the spoon or possibly the niblick of ingenuity. To fail now, to allow this girl to pass out of his life merely because he did not know who she was or where she was, would stamp him a feeble adventurer. A fellow could not expect luck to do everything for him. He must supplement its assistance with his own efforts. What had he to go on? Well, nothing much, if it came to that, except the knowledge that she lived some 2 hours by train out of London, and that her journey started from Waterloo Station. What would Sherlock Holmes have done? Concentrated thought supplied no answer to the question, and it was at this point that the cheery optimism with which he had begun the day left George and gave place to a grey gloom. A dreadful phrase, haunting in its pathos, crept into his mind. Ships that pass in the night. It might easily turn out that way. Indeed, thinking over the affair in all its aspects as he dried himself after his tub, George could not see how it could possibly turn out any other way. He dressed moodily, and left the room to go down to breakfast. Breakfast would at least alleviate this sinking feeling, which was unmanning him, and he could think more briskly after a cup or two of coffee. He opened the door. On a mat outside lay a letter. The handwriting was feminine. It was also in pencil, and strange to him. He opened the envelope. "Dear Mr. Bevan," it began. With a sudden leap of the heart, he looked at the signature. The letter was signed, "The Girl in the Cab." "Dear Mr. Bevan, I hope you won't think me very rude, running off without waiting to say good-bye. I had to. I saw Percy driving up in a cab, and knew that he must have followed us. He did not see me, so I got away all right. I managed splendidly about the money, for I remembered that I was wearing a nice brooch, and stopped on the way to the station to pawn it. Thank you ever so much, again, for all your wonderful kindness. Yours, The Girl in the Cab." George read the note twice on the way down to the breakfast-room, and 3 times more during the meal. Then, having committed its contents to memory down to the last comma, he gave himself up to glowing thoughts. What a girl! He had never in his life before met a woman who could write a letter without a postscript, and this was but the smallest of her unusual gifts. The resource of her, to think of pawning that brooch! The sweetness of her, to bother to send him a note! More than ever before was he convinced that he had met his ideal, and more than ever before was he determined that a triviality like being unaware of her name and address should not keep him from her. It was not as if he had no clue to go upon. He knew that she lived 2 hours from London and started home from Waterloo. It narrowed the thing down absurdly. There were only about 3 counties in which she could possibly live, and a man must be a poor fellow who is incapable of searching through a few small counties for the girl he loves, especially a man with luck like his. Luck is a goddess, not to be coerced and forcibly wooed by those who seek her favours. From such masterful spirits she turns away. But it happens sometimes that, if we put our hand in hers with the humble trust of a little child, she will have pity on us, and not fail us in our hour of need. On George, hopefully watching for something to turn up, she smiled almost immediately. It was George's practice, when he lunched alone, to relieve the tedium of the meal with the assistance of reading matter in the shape of one or more of the evening papers. Today, sitting down to a solitary repast at the Piccadilly Grill-room, he had brought with him an early edition of the Evening News, and one of the first items which met his eye was the following, embodied in a column on one of the inner pages devoted to humorous comments in prose and verse on the happenings of the day. This particular happening the writer had apparently considered worthy of being dignified by rhyme. It was headed, "The Peer and the Policeman." Outside the Carlton, 'tis averred, these stirring happenings occurred. The hour, 'tis said, and no one doubts, was 2:30 or thereabouts. The day was fair, the sky was blue, and everything was peaceful too, when suddenly a well-dressed gent engaged in heated argument, and roundly to abuse began another well-dressed gentleman. His suede-gloved fist he raised on high to dot the other in the eye. Who knows what horrors might have been, had there not come upon the scene old London City's favourite son, Policeman C. 231. "What means this conduct? Prithee, stop!" exclaimed that admirable Slop, with which he placed a warning hand upon the brawler's collar-band. We simply hate to tell the rest. No subject here for flippant jest. The mere remembrance of the tale has made our ink turn deadly pale. Let us be brief, some demon sent stark madness on the well-dressed gent. He gave the constable a punch just where the latter kept his lunch. The constable said, "Well, well, well," and marched him to a dungeon cell. At Vine Street Station, out it came. Lord Belpher was the culprit's name. But British justice is severe, alike on pauper and on peer. With even hand she holds the scale, a thumping fine in lieu of jail. Induced Lord B to feel remorse, and learn he mustn't punch the force. George's mutton chop congealed on the plate, untouched. The French fried potatoes cooled off unnoticed. This was no time for food. Rightly indeed had he relied upon his luck. It had stood by him nobly. With this clue, all was over except getting to the nearest free library and consulting Burke's Peerage. He paid his bill and left the restaurant. 10 minutes later he was drinking in the pregnant information that Belpher was the family name of the Earl of Marshmoreton, and that the present Earl had one son, Percy Wilbraham Marsh, educated at Eton and Christ Church, Oxford, and what the book with its customary curtness called 1D, Patricia Maud. The family seat, said Burke, was Belpher Castle, Belpher, Hants. Some hours later, seated on a first-class compartment of a train that moved slowly out of Waterloo Station, George watched London vanish behind him. In the pocket closest to his throbbing heart was a single ticket to Belpher. End of chapter 5.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org.
A Damsel in Distress, read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk. www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 6. At about the time that George Bevan's train was leaving Waterloo, a grey racing car drew up with a grinding of brake and a sputter of gravel in front of the main entrance of Belpher Castle. The slim and elegant young man at the wheel removed his goggles, pulled out a watch, and addressed the stout young man at his side. 2 hours and 18 minutes from Hyde Park Corner, Boots. Not so dusty, what?"
His companion made no reply. He appeared to be plunged in thought. He, too, removed his goggles, revealing a florid and gloomy face, equipped, in addition to the usual features, with a small moustache and an extra chin. He scowled forbiddingly at the charming scene which the goggles had hidden from him. Before him, a symmetrical mass of grey stone and green ivy, Belpher Castle, towered against a light blue sky. On either side, rolling parkland spread as far as the eye could see, carpeted here and there with violets, dotted with great oaks and ashes and Spanish chestnuts, orderly, peaceful, and English. Nearer, on his left, were rose gardens, in the centre of which, tilted at a sharp angle, appeared the seat of a pair of corduroy trousers, whose wearer seemed to be engaged in hunting for snails. Thrushes sang in the green shrubberies, rooks cawed in the elms. Somewhere, in the distance, sounded the tinkle of sheep bells and the lowing of cows. It was, in fact, a scene which, lit by the evening sun of a perfect spring day and fanned by a gentle westerly wind, should have brought balm and soothing meditations to one who was the sole heir to all this paradise. But Percy, Lord Belpher, remained uncomforted by the notable cooperation of man and nature, and drew no solace from the reflection that all these pleasant things would one day be his own. His mind was occupied at the moment, to the exclusion of all other thoughts, by the recollection of that painful scene in Bow Street Police Court. The magistrate's remarks, which had been tactless and unsympathetic, still echoed in his ears, and that infernal night in Vine Street Police Station. The darkness, the hard bed, the discordant vocalizing of the drunk and disorderly in the next cell. Time might soften these memories, might lessen the sharp agony of them, but nothing could remove them altogether. Percy had been shaken to the core of his being. Physically, he was still stiff and sore from the plank bed. Mentally, he was a volcano. He had been marched up the Haymarket in the full sight of all London by a bounder of a policeman. He had been talked to like an erring child by a magistrate, whom nothing could convince that he had not been under the influence of alcohol at the moment of his arrest. The man had said things about his liver, kindly be warned in time and pull up before it is too late things, which would have seemed to Percy indecently frank if spoken by his medical adviser in the privacy of the sick chamber. It is perhaps not to be wondered at that Belpher Castle, for all its beauty of scenery and architecture, should have left Lord Belpher a little cold. He was seething with a fury which the conversation of Reggie Byng had done nothing to allay in the course of the journey from London. Reggie was the last person he would willingly have chosen as a companion in his hour of darkness. Reggie was not soothing. He would insist on addressing him by his old Eton name of Boots, which Percy detested, and all the way down he had been breaking out at intervals into ribald comments on the recent unfortunate occurrence, which were very hard to bear. He resumed his vein as they alighted and rang the bell. "This," said Reggie, "is rather like a bit of the melodrama. Convict son totters up the steps of the old home and punches the bell. What awaits him beyond? Forgiveness or the raspberry? True, the white-haired butler who knew him as a child will sob on his neck, but what of the old dad? How will dad take the blot of the family escutcheon?" Lord Belpher's scowl deepened. "It's not a joking matter," he said coldly. "Great heavens, I'm not joking! How could I have the heart to joke at a moment like this, when the friend of my youth has suddenly become a social leper? I wish to goodness you would stop. Do you think it is any pleasure to me to be seen about with a man who is now known in criminal circles as Percy the Piccadilly Policeman Puncher? I keep a brave face for the world, but inwardly I burn with shame and agony and what not." The great door of the castle swung open, revealing Keggs, the butler. He was a man of reverend years, portly and dignified, with a respectfully benevolent face that beamed gravely on the young master and Mr. Byng, as if their coming had filled his cup of pleasure. His light, slightly protruding eyes expressed reverential goodwill. He gave just that touch of cosy humanity to the scene which the hall, with its half-lights and massive furniture, needed to make it perfect to the returned wanderer. He seemed to be intimating that this was a moment to which he had looked forward long, and that from now on quiet happiness would reign supreme. It is distressing to have to reveal the jarring fact that, in his hours of privacy when off duty, this apparently ideal servitor was so far from being a respecter of persons that he was accustomed to speak of Lord Belpher as Percy, and even as his Nibs. It was, indeed, an open secret among the upper servants at the castle, and a fact hinted at with awe among the lower that Keggs was at heart a socialist. "Good evening, Your Lordship. Good evening, sir." Lord Belpher acknowledged the salutation with a grunt, but Reggie was more affable. "How are you, Keggs? Now's your time, if you're going to do it." He stepped a little to one side and indicated Lord Belpher's crimson neck with an inviting gesture. "I beg your pardon, sir?"
You'd rather wait till you can do it a little more privately. Perhaps you're right." The butler smiled indulgently. He did not understand what Reggie was talking about, but that did not worry him. He had long since come to the conclusion that Reggie was slightly mad, a theory supported by the latter's valet, who was of the same opinion. Keggs did not dislike Reggie, but intellectually he considered him negligible. "Send something to drink into the library, Keggs," said Lord Belpher. "Very good, your lordship." "A topping idea," said Reggie. "I'll just take the old car round to the garage, and then I'll be with you." He climbed to the steering wheel and started the engine. Lord Belpher proceeded to the library while Keggs melted away through the green baize door at the end of the hall, which divided the servants' quarters from the rest of the house. Reggie had hardly driven a dozen yards when he perceived his stepmother and Lord Marshmoreton coming towards him from the direction of the rose garden. He drew up to greet them. "Hello, Mater. What ho, uncle? Back again at the old homestead, what?" Beneath Lady Caroline's aristocratic front, agitation seemed to lurk. "Reggie, where is Percy?" "Old Boots? I think he's to the library. I just decanted him out of the car." Lady Caroline turned to her brother. "Let us go to the library, John." "All right, all right, all right," said Lord Marshmoreton irritably. Something appeared to have ruffled his calm. Reggie drove on. As he was strolling back after putting the car away, he met Maud. "Hello, Maud, dear old thing." "Why, hello, Reggie. I was expecting you back last night." "Couldn't get back last night. Had to stick in town and rally round old Boots. Couldn't desert the old boy in his hour of trial." Reggie chuckled amusedly. "Hour of trial. It's rather good, what? What I mean to say is that it's just what it was, don't you know?" "Why, what happened to Percy?" "Do you mean to say you haven't heard? Oh, of course not. It couldn't have been in the morning papers. Why, Percy punched a policeman."
"Percy did what?"
"Slugged a slop. Most dramatic thing. Sloshed him in the midriff. Absolutely. The cross marks, the spot where the tragedy occurred." Maud caught her breath. Somehow, though she could not trace the connection, she felt that this extraordinary happening must be linked up with her escapade. Then her sense of humour got the better of apprehension. Her eyes twinkled delightedly. "You don't mean to say Percy did that?"
"Absolutely. The human targa and what not. Menace to society and all that sort of thing. No holding him. For some unexplained reason that generous blood of the Belfers boiled over. And then zing! They jerked him off to the Vine Street like the poem, don't you know? And poor old Percy walked between with gives up on his wrists. And this morning, bright and early, the beak parted him from 10 quid. You know, Maud, old thing, our duty stares us plainly in the eyeball. We've got to train old Boots down to a reasonable weight and spring him on the National Sporting Club. We've been letting a champion middleweight blush unseen under our very roof-tree." Maud hesitated a moment.
"I suppose you don't know," she asked carelessly, "why he did it? I mean, did he tell you anything?"
"Couldn't get a word out of him. Oysters garrulous and tombs chatty in comparison. Absolutely. All I know is that he popped one into the officer's waistband. What led up to it is more than I can tell you. How would it be to stagger to the library and join the post-mortem?"
"The post-mortem?"
"Well, I met the Mater and his lordship on their way to the library, and it looked to me very much as if the Mater must have got hold of the evening paper on her journey from town. When did she arrive?"
"Only a short while ago."
"Then that's what's happened. She would have bought an evening paper to read on the train. By Jove, I wonder if she got hold of the one that had that poem about it. One chappie was so carried away by the beauty of the episode that he treated it in verse. I think we got to look in and see what's happening."
Maud hesitated again, but she was a girl of spirit, and she had an intuition that her best defence would be to attack. Bluff was what was needed. Wide-eyed, innocent wonder. After all, Percy couldn't be certain he had seen her in Piccadilly. "All right. By the way, dear old girl," inquired Reggie, "did your little business come out satisfactory? I've got to ask."
"Not very, but it was awfully sweet of you to take me into town."
"How would it be," said Reggie nervously, "not to dwell too much on that part of it? What I mean to say is, for heaven's sake, don't let the Mater know I rallied round."
"Oh, don't worry," said Maud with a laugh. "I'm not going to talk about the thing at all."
Lord Belpher, meanwhile, in the library, had begun with the aid of a whisky and soda to feel a little better. There was something about the library, with its sombre half-tones, that soothed his bruised spirit. The room held something of the peace of a deserted city. The world, with its violent adventures and tall policemen, did not enter here. There was balm in those rows and rows of books which nobody ever read, those vast writing-tables at which nobody ever wrote. From the broad mantelpiece, the bust of some unnamed ancient looked down almost sympathetically. Something remotely resembling peace had begun to steal into Percy's soul, when it was expelled by the abrupt opening of the door and the entry of Lady Caroline Byng and his father. One glance at the face of the former was enough to tell Lord Belpher that she knew all. He rose defensively. "Let me explain.
Lady Caroline quivered with repressed emotion. This masterly woman had not lost control of herself, but her aristocratic calm had seldom been so severely tested. As Reggie had surmised, she had read the report of the proceedings in the evening paper on the train, and her world had been reeling ever since. Caesar, stabbed by Brutus, could scarcely have experienced greater shock. The other members of her family had disappointed her often. She had become inured to the spectacle of her brother working in the garden in corduroy trousers, and in other ways behaving in a manner beneath the dignity of an Earl of Marshmoreton. She had resigned herself to the innate flaw in the character of Maud which had allowed her to fall in love with a nobody whom she had met without an introduction. Even Reggie had exhibited at times democratic traits of which she thoroughly disapproved. But of her nephew Percy she had always been sure. He was solid rock. He, at least, she had always felt, would never do anything to injure the family prestige. And now, so to speak, lo, Ben Adhem's name led all the rest. In other words, Percy was the worst of the lot. Whatever indiscretions the rest had committed, at least they had never got the family into the comic columns of the evening papers. Lord Marshmoreton might wear corduroy trousers and refuse to entertain the county at garden parties, and Reggie might be seen at fashionable restaurants with pugilists. But at any rate, evening paper poets had never written facetious verses about their exploits. This crowning degradation had been reserved for the hitherto blameless Percy, who of all the young men of Lady Caroline's acquaintance had till now appeared to have the most scrupulous sense of his position, the most rigid regard for the dignity of his great name. Yet here he was, if the carefully considered reports in the daily press were to be believed, spending his time in the very springtide of his life running about London like a frenzied Hottentot, brutally assaulting the police. Lady Caroline felt as a bishop might feel if he suddenly discovered that some favourite curate had gone over to the worship of Mumbo Jumbo.
"Explain!" she cried. "How can you explain? You, my nephew, the heir to the title, behaving like a common rowdy in the streets of London! Your name in the papers! If you knew the circumstances! The circumstances! They are in the evening paper! They are in print!"
"In verse," added Lord Marshmoreton. He chuckled amiably at the recollection. He was an easily amused man. "You ought to read it, my boy. Some of it is capital."
"John!"
"But deplorable, of course," added Lord Marshmoreton hastily. "Very deplorable." He endeavoured to regain his sister's esteem by a show of righteous indignation.
"What do you mean by it, damn it? You're my only son. I have watched you grow from child to boy, from boy to man, with tender solicitude. I have wanted to be proud of you, and all the same, dash it, you are prowling about London like a lion seeking whom you may devour, terrorizing the metropolis, putting harmless policemen in fear of their lives. Will you listen to me for a moment?" shouted Percy, who began to speak rapidly, as one conscious of the necessity of saying his say while the saying was good. "The facts are these. I was walking along Piccadilly, on my way to lunch at the club, when near Burlington Arcade I was amazed to see Maud." Lady Caroline uttered an exclamation.
"Maud? But Maud was here!"
"I can't understand it," went on Lord Marshmoreton, pursuing his remarks. Righteous indignation had, he felt, gone well. It might be judicious to continue in that vein, though privately he held the opinion that nothing in Percy's life so became him as this assault on the force. Lord Marshmoreton, who in his time had committed all the follies of youth, had come to look on his blameless son as scarcely human. "It's not as if you were wild. You've never got into any scrapes at Oxford. You spent your time collecting old china and prayer rugs. You wear flannel next to your skin. Will you please be quiet?" said Lady Caroline impatiently. "Go on, Percy."
"Oh, very well," said Lord Marshmoreton. "I only spoke. I merely made a remark. You say you saw Maud in Piccadilly, Percy?"
"Precisely. I was on the point of putting it down to an extraordinary resemblance when suddenly she got into a cab, and then I knew."
Lord Marshmoreton could not permit this to pass in silence. He was a fair-minded man. "Why shouldn't the girl have got into a cab? Why must a girl walking along Piccadilly be my daughter Maud just because she got into a cab? London," he proceeded, warming to the argument, and thrilled by the clearness and coherence of his reasoning, "is full of girls who take cabs. She didn't take a cab."
"You just said she did," said Lord Marshmoreton cleverly.
"I said she got into a cab. There was somebody else already in the cab. A man, Aunt Caroline. It was a man."
"Good gracious!" ejaculated Lady Caroline, falling into a chair as if she had been hamstrung.
"I am absolutely convinced of it," proceeded Lord Belpher solemnly. "His behaviour was enough to confirm my suspicions. The cab had stopped in a block of the traffic, and I went up and requested him, in a perfectly civil manner, to allow me to look at the lady who had just got in. He denied that there was a lady in the cab, and I had seen her jump in with my own eyes. Throughout the conversation, he was leaning out of the window with the obvious intention of screening whoever was inside from my view. I followed him along Piccadilly in another cab and tracked him to the Carlton. When I arrived there, he was standing on the pavement outside. There were no signs of Maud. I demanded that he tell me her whereabouts. That reminds me, said Lord Marshmoreton cheerfully, of a story I read in one of the papers. I dare say it's old. Stop me if you've read it. A woman says to the maid, "Do you know anything of my husband's whereabouts?" And the maid replies, "Do be quiet," snapped Lady Caroline. "I should have thought that you would be interested in a matter affecting the vital welfare of your only daughter." "I am, I am," said Lord Marshmoreton hastily. The maid replied, "There at the wash." "Of course I am. Go on, Percy. Good God, boy, don't take all day telling us your story." At that moment the fool of the policeman came up and wanted to know what the matter was. I lost my head. I admit it freely. The policeman grasped my shoulder and I struck him. "Where?" asked Lord Marshmoreton, a stickler for detail. "What does that matter?" demanded Lady Caroline. "You did quite right, Percy. These insolent jacks in office ought not to be allowed to manhandle people. Tell me what this man was like." "Extremely ordinary looking. In fact, all I can remember about him was that he was clean-shaven. I cannot understand how Maud could have come to lose her head over such a man. He seemed to me to have no attraction whatever," said Lord Belpher, a little unreasonably, for Apollo himself could hardly appear attractive when knocking off one's best hat. "It must have been the same man." "Precisely. If we wanted further proof, he was an American. You recollect we heard that the man in Wales was American." There was a portentous silence. Percy stared at the floor. Lady Caroline breathed deeply. Lord Marshmoreton, feeling that something was expected of him, said, "Good gad!" and gazed seriously at a stuffed owl on a bracket. Maud and Reggie Byng came in. "What ho, what ho, what ho!" said Reggie breezily. He always believed in starting a conversation well and putting people at their ease. "What ho, what ho!" Maud braced herself for the encounter. "Hello, Percy dear," she said, meeting her brother's accusing eye with the perfect composure that comes only from a thoroughly guilty conscience. "What's all this I hear about your being the scourge of London? Reggie says that policemen dive down manholes when they see you coming." The chill in the air would have daunted a less courageous girl. Lady Caroline had risen and was staring sternly. Percy was pulling the puffs on an overwrought soul. Lord Marshmoreton, whose thoughts had wandered off to the rose garden, pulled himself together and tried to look menacing. Maud went on without waiting for a reply. She was all bubbling gaiety and insouciance, a charming picture of young English girlhood that nearly made her brother foam at the mouth. "Father dear," she said, attaching herself affectionately to his buttonhole, "I went round the links in 83 this morning. I did the long hole in 4, one under par, a thing I've never done before in my life." "Bless my soul," said Lord Marshmoreton weakly, as with an apprehensive eye on his sister he patted his daughter's shoulder. "First I sent a screecher of a drive right down the middle of the fairway, and then I took my bracey and put the ball just on the edge of the green, 180 yards if it was an inch. My approach putt—" Lady Caroline was no devotee of the royal and ancient game, interrupted the recital. "Never mind what you did this morning. What did you do yesterday afternoon?" "Yes," said Lord Belpher, "where were you yesterday afternoon?" Maud's gaze was the gaze of a young child who has never even attempted to put anything over in all its little life. "Whatever do you mean? What were you doing in Piccadilly yesterday afternoon?" said Lady Caroline. "Piccadilly? The place where Percy fights policemen? I don't understand." Lady Caroline was no sportsman. She put one of those direct questions capable of being answered only by yes or no, which ought not to be allowed in controversy. They were the verbal equivalent of shooting a sitting bird. "Did you or did you not go to London yesterday, Maud?" The monstrous unfairness of this method of attack pained Maud. From childhood up she had held the customary feminine views upon the lie, direct. As long as it was a question of suppression of the true or suggestion of the false, she had no scruples. But she had a distaste for the deliberate falsehood. Faced now with a choice between two evils, she chose the one which would at least leave her self-respect.
"Yes, I did."
Lady Caroline looked at Lord Belpher. Lord Belpher looked at Lady Caroline. "You went to meet that American of yours." Reggie Byng slid softly from the room. He felt that he would be happier elsewhere. He had been an acutely embarrassed spectator of this distressing scene, and had been passing the time by shuffling his feet, playing with his coat buttons, and perspiring. "Don't go, Reggie," said Lord Belpher. "Oh, well, what I mean to say is family row and what not. If you see what I mean, I've one or two things I ought to do." He vanished. Lord Belpher frowned a sombre frown. "Then it was that man who knocked my hat off?" "What do you mean?" said Lady Caroline. "Knocked your hat off? You never told me he knocked your hat off." "It was when I was asking him to let me look inside the cab. I had grasped the handle of the door when he suddenly struck my hat, causing it to fly off, and while I was picking it up, he drove away. Exploded Lord Marshmoreton. He twisted his face by a supreme exertion of willpower into a mask of indignation. "You ought to have had that scoundrel arrested," he said vehemently. "It was a technical assault." "The man who knocked your hat off, Percy," said Maud, "was not. He was a different man altogether. A stranger." "As if you would be in a cab with a stranger," said Lady Caroline caustically. "There are limits, I hope, to even your indiscretions." Lord Marshmoreton cleared his throat. He was sorry for Maud, whom he loved. "Now, looking at the matter broadly..." "Be quiet," said Lady Caroline. Lord Marshmoreton subsided. "I wanted to avoid you," said Maud, "so I jumped into the first cab I saw." "I don't believe it," said Percy. "It's the truth. You are simply trying to put us off the scent." Lady Caroline turned to Maud. Her manner was plaintive. She looked like a martyr at the stake who depreciatingly lodges a timid complaint, fearful the while lest she may be hurting the feelings of her persecutors by appearing even for a moment out of sympathy with their activities. "My dear child, why will you not be reasonable in this matter? Why will you not let yourself be guided by those who are older and wiser than you?" "Exactly," said Lord Belpher. "The whole thing is too absurd." "Precisely," said Lord Belpher. Lady Caroline turned on him irritably. "Please do not interrupt, Percy. Now you've made me forget what I was going to say." "To my mind," said Lord Marshmoreton, coming to the surface once more, "the proper attitude to adopt on occasions like the present..." "Please," said Lady Caroline. Lord Marshmoreton stopped and resumed his silent communion with the stuffed bird. "You can't stop yourself being in love, Aunt Caroline," said Maud. "You can be stopped if you've somebody with a level head looking after you." Lord Marshmoreton tore himself away from the bird. "Why, when I was at Oxford in the year 87, he said chattily, "I fancied myself in love with a female assistant at the tobacconist's shop. Desperately in love, damn it. Wanted to marry her. I recollect my poor father took me away from Oxford and kept me here at Belpher under lock and key. Lock and key, damn it. I was deucedly upset at the time, I remember. His mind wandered off into the glorious past. I wonder what that girl's name was. Odd one can't remember names. She had chestnut hair and a mole on the side of her chin. I used to kiss it, I recollect." Lady Caroline, usually such an advocate of her brother's researches into the family history, cut the reminiscence short. "Never mind that now." "I don't. I got over it. That's the moral." "Well," said Lady Caroline, "at any rate, poor father acted with great good sense on that occasion. There seems nothing to do but to treat Maud in just the same way. You shall not stir a step from this castle till you have got over this dreadful infatuation. You will be watched." "I shall watch you," said Lord Belpher solemnly. "I shall watch your every movement." A dreamy look came into Maud's brown eyes. "Stone walls do not a prison make, nor iron bars a cage," she said softly. "That wasn't your experience, Percy, my boy," said Lord Marshmoreton. "They make a very good imitation," said Lady Caroline coldly, ignoring the interruption. Maud faced her defiantly. She looked like a princess in captivity facing her jailers. "I don't care. I love him, and I always shall love him, and nothing is ever going to stop me loving him, because I love him," she concluded a little lamely. "Nonsense," said Lady Caroline. "In a year from now, you will have forgotten his name. Don't you agree with me, Percy?" "Quite," said Lord Belpher. "I shan't." "Deuced hard things to remember names," said Lord Marshmoreton. "If I've tried once to remember that tobacconist girl's name, I've tried 100 times. I have an idea it began with an L. Muriel or Hilda or something." "Within a year," said Lady Caroline, "you will be wondering how you ever came to be so foolish. Don't you think so, Percy?" "Quite," said Lord Belpher. Lord Marshmoreton turned on him irritably. "Good God, boy, can't you answer a simple question with a plain affirmative? What do you mean, quite? If somebody came up to me and pointed you out and said, 'Is that your son?' do you suppose I should say, 'Quite?' I wish the devil you didn't collect prayer rugs. It sapped your brain." "They say prison life often weakens the intellect, father," said Maud. She moved towards the door and turned the handle. Albert, the page boy, who had been courting earache by listening at the keyhole, straightened his small body and scuttled away. "Well, is that all, Aunt Caroline? May I go now?" "Certainly. I have said all I wish to say." "Very well. I am sorry to disobey you, but I can't help it." "You'll find you can help it after you've been cooped up here for a few more months," said Percy. A gentle smile played over Maud's face. "Love laughs at locksmiths," she murmured softly, and passed from the room. "What did she say?" said Lord Marshmoreton, interested. "Something about somebody laughing at a locksmith? I don't understand. Why should anyone laugh at locksmiths? Most respectable men. Had one up here only the day before yesterday, forcing open the drawer of my desk. Watched him do it. Most interesting. He smelt rather strongly of a damn bad brand of tobacco. Fellow must have had a throat of leather to be able to smoke the stuff. But he didn't strike me as an object of derision. From first to last, I was never tempted to laugh once. Lord Belpher wandered moodily to the window and looked out into the gathering darkness. "And this has to happen," he said bitterly, "on the eve of my 21st birthday." End of chapter 6.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Yas Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Woodhouse. Chapter 7. The first requisite of an invading army is a base. George, having entered Belpher Village and thus accomplished the first stage in his forward movement on the castle, selected as his base the Marshmoreton Arms. Selected is perhaps hardly the right word, as it implies choice. And in George's case there was no choice. There are two inns at Belpher, but the Marshmoreton Arms is the only one that offers accommodation for man and beast, assuming, that is to say, that the man and beast desire to spend the night. The other house, the Blue Boar, is a mere beer-house, where the lower strata of Belpher society gather of a night to quench their thirst and to tell one another interminable stories without any point whatsoever. But the Marshmoreton Arms is a comfortable, respectable hostelry, catering to the village plutocrats. There of an evening you will find the local veterinary surgeon smoking a pipe with the grocer, the baker, and the butcher, with perhaps a sprinkling of neighbouring farmers to help the conversation along. There is a shilling ordinary, which is the rural English, for a cut off the joint and a boiled potato, followed by hunks of the sort of cheese which believes that it pays to advertise, and this is usually well attended. On the other days of the week, until late to the evening, however, the visitor to the Marshmoreton Arms has the place almost entirely to himself. It is to be questioned whether in the whole length and breadth of the world there is a more admirable spot for a man in love to pass a day or two than the typical English village. The Rocky Mountains, that traditional stamping ground for the heartbroken, may be well enough in their way, but a lover has to be cast in a pretty stem mould to be able to be introspective when at any moment he may meet an annoyed cinnamon bear. In the English village there are no such obstacles to meditation. It combines the comforts of civilization with the restfulness of solitude in a manner equalled by no other spot except the New York Public Library. Here your lover may wander to and fro unmolested, speaking to nobody, by nobody addressed, and have the satisfaction at the end of the day of sitting down to a capitally cooked chop and chips, lubricated by golden English ale. Belpher, in addition to all the advantages of the usual village, has a quiet charm all its own, due to the fact that it has seen better days. In a sense, it is a ruin, and ruins are always soothing to the bruised soul. 10 years before, Belpher had been a flourishing centre of the South of England oyster trade. It is situated by the shore, where Hayling Island, lying athwart the mouth of the bay, forms the waters into a sort of brackish lagoon, in much the same way as Fire Island shuts off the great South Bay of Long Island from the waves of the Atlantic. The water of Belpher Creek is shallow even at high tide, and when the tide runs out it leaves glistening mudflats, which is the particular taste of the oyster to prefer to any other habitation. For years Belpher oysters had been the mainstay of gay supper parties at the Savoy, the Carlton, and Romano's. Dukes doted on them, chorus girls wept if they were not on the bill of fare. And then, in an evil hour, somebody discovered that what made the Belpher oyster so particularly plump and succulent was the fact that it breakfasted, lunched, and dined almost entirely on the local sewage. There is but a thin line ever between popular homage and execration. We see it in the case of politicians, generals, and prize-fighters, and oysters are no exception to the rule. There was a typhoid scare, quite a passing and unjustified scare, but strong enough to do its deadly work. And almost overnight, Belpher passed from a place of flourishing industry to the sleepy, by-the-world-forgotten spot which it was when George Bevan discovered it. The shallow water is still there, the mud is still there, even the oyster beds are still there, but not the oysters, nor the little world of activity which had sprung up around them. The glory of Belpher is dead, and over its gates Ichabod is written. But if it has lost in importance, it has gained in charm, and George, for one, had no regrets. To him, in his present state of mental upheaval, Belpher was the ideal spot. It was not at first that George roused himself to the point of asking why he was here, and what, now that he was here, he proposed to do. For two languorous days he loafed, sufficiently occupied with his thoughts. He smoked long, peaceful pipes in the stable-yard, watching the ostlers as they groomed the horses. He played with the inn puppy, bestowed respectful caresses on the inn cat. He walked down the quaint, cobbled street to the harbour, sauntered along the shore, and lay on his back on the little beach at the other side of the lagoon, from where he could see the red roofs of the village, while the imitation waves splashed busily on the stones, trying to conceal, with bustle and energy, the fact that the water, even 200 yards from the shore, was only 18 inches deep. For it is the abiding hope of Belpher Creek that it may be able to deceive the occasional visitor into mistaking it for the open sea. And presently the tide would ebb. The waste of waters became a sea of mud, cheerfully covered as to much of its surface with green grasses. The evening sun struck rainbow colours from the moist softness. Birds sang in the thickets, and George, heaving himself up, walked back to the friendly cosiness of the Marshmoreton Arms. And the remarkable part of it was that everything seemed perfectly natural and sensible to him, nor had he any particular feeling that in falling in love with Lady Maud Marsh and pursuing her to Belpher he had set himself anything in the nature of a hopeless task. Like one kissed by a goddess in a dream, he walked on air. And while one is walking on air, it is easy to overlook the boulders in the path. Consider his position, you faint-hearted and self-pitying young men who think you have a tough row to hoe, just because, when you pay your evening visit with the pound box of candy under your arm, you see the handsome sophomore from Yale sitting beside her on the porch playing the ukulele. If ever the world has turned black to you in such a situation, and the moon gone in behind a cloud, think of George Bevan and what he was up against. You are at least on the spot. You can at least put up a fight. If there are ukuleles in the world, there are also guitars. And tomorrow it may be you and not he who sits on the moonlit porch. It may be he and not you who arrives late. Who knows? Tomorrow he may not show up till you have finished the Bedouin's love song and are annoying the local birds roosting in the trees with poor butterfly. What I mean to say is, you are on the map. You have a sporting chance. Whereas George... Well, just go over to England and try wooing an earl's daughter, whom you have only met once, and then without an introduction, whose brother's hat you have smashed beyond repair, whose family wishes her to marry some other man, who wants to marry some other man herself, and not the same other man, but another other man, who is closely immured in a medieval castle. Well, all I say is, try it. And then go back to your porch with a chastened spirit, and admit that you might be a whole lot worse off. George, as I say, had not envisaged the peculiar difficulties of his position. Nor did he until the evening of his second day at the Marshmoreton Arms. Until then, as I have indicated, he roamed in a golden mist of dreamy meditation among the soothing byways of the village of Belpher. But after lunch on the second day, it came upon him that all this sort of thing was pleasant, but not practical. Action was what was needed. Action. The first, the obvious move, was to locate the castle. Inquiries at the Marshmoreton Arms elicited the fact that it was a step up the road that ran past the front door of the inn. But this wasn't the day of the week when the general public was admitted. The sightseer could invade Belpher Castle on Thursdays only, between the hours of 2 and 4. On other days of the week, all he could do was stand like Moses on Pisgah and take in the general effect from a distance. As this was all that George had hoped to be able to do, he set forth. It speedily became evident to George that a step was a euphemism. 5 miles did he tramp before, trudging wearily up a winding lane, he came out on a breeze-swept hilltop, and saw below him, nestling in its trees, what was now for him the centre of the world. He sat on a stone wall and lit a pipe. Belpher Castle, Maud's home, there it was. And now what? The first thought that came to him was practical, even prosaic. The thought that he couldn't possibly do this 5 miles there and 5 miles back walk every time he wanted to see the place. He must shift his base nearer the scene of operations. One of those trim, thatched cottages down there in the valley would be just the thing, if he could arrange to take possession of it. They sat there all around the castle, singly and in groups, like small dogs round their master. They looked as if they had been there for centuries. Probably they had, as they were made of stone as solid as that of the castle. There must have been a time, thought George, when the castle was the central rallying point for all those scattered homes, when rumour of danger from marauders had sent all that little community scuttling for safety to the sheltering walls. For the first time since he had set out on his expedition, a certain chill, a discomforting sinking of the heart, afflicted George as he gazed down at the grim grey fortress which he had undertaken to storm. So must have felt those marauders of old, when they climbed to the top of this very hill to spy out the land. And George's case was even worse than theirs. They could at least hope that a strong arm and a stout heart would carry them past those solid walls. They had not to think of social etiquette. Whereas George was so situated that an unsympathetic butler could put him to rout by refusing him admittance. The evening was drawing in. Already, in the brief time he had spent on the hilltop, the sky had turned from blue to saffron, and from saffron to grey. The plaintive voices of homing cows floated up to him from the valley below. A bat had left its shelter and was wheeling around him, a sinister blot against the sky. A sickle moon gleamed over the trees. George felt cold. He turned. The shadows of night wrapped him round, and little things in the hedgerows chirped and chittered mockery at him as he stumbled down the lane. George's request for a lonely furnished cottage somewhere in the neighbourhood of the castle did not, as he had feared, strike the Belpher house agent as the demand of a lunatic. Every well-dressed stranger who comes to Belpher is automatically set down by the natives as an artist, for the picturesqueness of the place has caused it to be much infested by the brothers and sisters of the brush. In asking for a cottage, indeed, George did precisely as Belpher society expected him to do, and the agent was reaching for his list almost before the words were out of his mouth. In less than half an hour, George was out of the street again, the owner for the season of what the agent described as a gem, and the employer of a farmer's wife who lived nearby and would, as was her custom with the artists, come in the morning and evening to do for him. The interview would have taken but a few minutes, had it not been prolonged by the chattiness of the agent on the subject of the occupants of the castle, to which George listened attentively. He was not greatly encouraged by what he heard of Lord Marshmoreton. The Earl had made himself notably unpopular in the village recently by his firm, the house agent said, pig-headed attitude in respect to a certain dispute about a right-of-way. It was Lady Caroline, and not their easy-going peer, who was really to blame for the matter. But the impression George got from the house agent's description of Lord Marshmoreton was that the latter was a sort of Nero, possessing, in addition to the qualities of a Roman tyrant, many of the least lovable traits of the Gila Monster of Arizona. Hearing this about her father, and having already had the privilege of meeting her brother and studying him at first hand, his heart bled for Maud. It seemed to him that existence at the castle in such society must be little short of torture. "I must do something," he muttered.
I must do something quick.
Beg pardon? Said the house agent.
Nothing, said George.
Well, I'll take that cottage. I'd better write you a cheque for the first month's rent now.
So George took up his abode, full of strenuous, if vague, purpose, in the plainly furnished but not uncomfortable cottage, known locally as the one down by Platt's. He might have found a worse billet. It was a two-storied building of stained red brick, not one of the thatched nests on which he had looked down from the hill. Those were not for rent, being occupied by families whose ancestors had occupied them for generations back. The one down by Platt's was a more modern structure, a speculation, in fact, of the farmer whose wife had come to do for George, and designed especially to accommodate the stranger who had the desire and the money to rent it. It so departed from type that it possessed a small but undeniable bathroom. Besides this miracle, there was a cozy sitting-room, a larger bedroom on the floor above, and next to this an empty room facing north, which had evidently served artist occupants as a studio. The remainder of the ground floor was taken up by kitchen and scullery. The furniture had been constructed by somebody who would probably have done very well if he had taken up some other line of industry, but it was mitigated by a very fine and comfortable wicker easy-chair, left there by one of last year's artists. And other artists had helped along the good work by relieving the plainness of the walls with a landscape or two. In fact, when George had removed from the room two antimacassars, three group photographs of the farmer's relations, an illuminated text, and a china statuette of the infant Samuel, and stacked them in a corner of the empty studio, the place became almost a home from home. Solitude can be very unsolitary if a man is in love. George never even began to be bored. The only thing that in any way troubled his peace was the thought that he was not accomplishing a great deal in the matter of helping Maud out of whatever trouble it was that had befallen her. The most he could do was to prowl along about roads near the castle in the hope of an accidental meeting. And such was his good fortune that, on the fourth day of his vigil, the accidental meeting occurred. Taking his morning prowl along the lanes, he was rewarded by the sight of a grey racing car at the side of the road. It was empty, but from underneath it protruded a pair of long legs, while beside it stood a girl, at the sight of whom George's heart began to thump so violently that the long-legged one might have been pardoned had he supposed that his engine had started again of its own volition. Until he spoke, the soft grass had kept her from hearing his approach. He stopped close beside her, and cleared his throat. She started and turned, and their eyes met. For a moment hers were empty of any recognition. Then they lit up. She caught her breath quickly, and a faint flush came into her face. "Can I help you?" asked George. The long legs wriggled out into the road, followed by a long body. The young man under the car sat up, turning a grease-streaked and pleasant face to George. "Eh? What?" "Can I help you? I know how to fix a car." The young man beamed in friendly fashion. "It's awfully good of you, old chap. But so do I. It's the only thing I can do well. Thanks very much, so forth, and all the same." George fastened his eyes on the girl's. She had not spoken. "If there is anything in the world I can possibly do for you," he said slowly, "I hope you will let me know. I should like, above all things, to help you." The girl spoke. "Thank you," she said in a low voice, almost inaudible. George walked away. The grease-streaked young man followed him with his gaze. "Civil cove, that," he said. "Rather gushing, though, what? American, wasn't he?"
"Yes, I think he was."
"Americans are the civilest coves I ever struck. I remember asking the way of a chappie at Baltimore a couple of years ago when I was there in my yacht, and he followed me for miles, shrieking advice and encouragement. I thought it deuced civil of him."
"I wish you would hurry up and get the car right, Reggie. We shall be awfully late for lunch."
Reggie Byng began to slide backwards under the car.
"All right then, dear heart. Rely on me. It's something quite simple."
"Well, do be quick."
"Imitation of grease lightning. Very difficult,"
said Reggie encouragingly. "Be patient. Try and amuse yourself somehow. Ask yourself a riddle. Tell yourself a few anecdotes. I'll be with you in a moment. I say, I wonder what the cove is doing at Belpher." "Deuced civil cove," said Reggie approvingly. "I liked him. And now, business of repairing breakdown." His smiling face vanished under the car like the Cheshire Cat. Maud stood looking thoughtfully down the road, in the direction in which George had disappeared. End of chapter 7.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse, as read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk, www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 8. The following day was a Thursday, and on Thursdays, as has been stated, Belpher Castle was thrown open to the general public between the hours of 2 and 4. It was a tradition of long standing, this periodical lowering of the barriers, and had always been faithfully observed by Lord Marshmoreton ever since his accession to the title. By the permanent occupants of the castle the day was regarded with mixed feelings. Lord Belpher, while approving of it in theory, as he did of all the family traditions, for he was a great supporter of all things feudal, and took his position as one of the hereditary aristocracy of Great Britain extremely seriously, heartily disliked it in practice. More than once he had been obliged to exit hastily by a further door in order to keep from being discovered by a drove of tourists intent on inspecting the library or the great drawing-room, and now it was his custom to retire to his bedroom immediately after lunch and not to emerge until the tide of invasion had ebbed away. Keggs, the butler, always looked forward to Thursdays with pleasurable anticipation. He enjoyed the sense of authority which it gave him to herd these poor outcasts to and fro among the surroundings which were an everyday commonplace to himself. Also, he liked hearing the sound of his own voice as it lectured in rolling periods on the objects of interest by the wayside. But even to Keggs there was a bitter mixed with the sweet. No one was better aware than himself that the nobility of his manner, excellent as a means of impressing the mob, worked against him when it came to a question of tips. Again and again had he been harrowed by the spectacle of tourists huddled together like sheep, debating among themselves in nervous whispers as to whether they could offer this personage anything so contemptible as half a crown for himself, and deciding that such an insult was out of the question. It was his endeavour, especially toward the end of the proceedings, to cultivate a manner blending a dignity fitting his position with a sunny geniality which would allay the timid doubts of the tourist and indicate to him that, bizarre as the idea might seem, there was nothing to prevent him placing his poor silver in more worthy hands. Possibly the only member of the castle community who was absolutely indifferent to these public visits was Lord Marshmoreton. He made no difference between Thursday and any other day. Precisely as usual, he donned his stained corduroys and pottered out to his beloved garden, and when, as happened on average once a quarter, some visitor strayed from the main herd and came upon him as he worked, and mistook him for one of the gardeners. He accepted the error without any attempt at explanation, sometimes going so far as to encourage it by adopting a rustic accent in keeping with his appearance. This sort of thing tickled the simple-minded peer. George joined the procession punctually at 2 o'clock, just as Keggs was clearing his throat, preparatory to saying, "We are now in the main hall, and before going any further, I would like to call your attention to Sir Peter Lely's portrait of..." It was his custom to begin his Thursday lectures with this remark, but today it was postponed, for no sooner had George appeared than a breezy voice on the outskirts of the throng spoke in a tone that made competition impossible. "For goodness sake, George!" And Billy Dore detached herself from the group, a trim vision in blue. She wore a dust coat and a motor veil, and her eyes and cheeks were glowing from the fresh air. "For goodness sake, George, what are you doing here?" "I was just going to ask you the same thing." "Oh, I motored down with a boy I know. We had a breakdown just outside the gates. We were on our way to Brighton for lunch. He suggested I should pass the time seeing the sights while he fixed up the sprockets, or the differential gear, or whatever it was. He's coming to pick me up when he's through. But on the level, George, how do you get this way? You sneak out of town and leave the show flat, and nobody has a notion where you are,
Why, we were thinking of advertising for you, or going to the police or something. For all anybody knew, you might have been sandbagged or dropped in the river. This aspect of the matter had not occurred to George till now. His sudden descent on Belpher had seemed to him the only natural course to pursue. He had not realized that he would be missed, and that his absence might have caused some grave inconvenience to a large number of people. I never thought of that. I just happened to come here. You aren't living in this old castle? Not quite. I've a cottage down the road. I wanted a few days in the country, so I rented it. But what made you choose this place? Keggs, who had been regarding these disturbers of the peace with dignified disapproval, coughed. If you would not mind, madam, we are waiting. Eh? How's that? Miss Dore looked up with a bright smile. I'm sorry. Come along, George. Get in the game. She nodded cheerfully to the butler. All right. All set now. You may fire when ready, Gridley. Keggs bowed austerely and cleared his throat again. We are now in the main hall, and before going any further, I would like to call your attention to Sir Peter Lely's portrait to the 5th Countess, said by experts to be his best manner. There was an almost soundless murmur from the mob, expressive of wonder and awe, like a gentle breeze rustling the leaves. Billie Dore resumed her conversation in a whisper. Yes, there was an awful lot of excitement when they found that you had disappeared. They were phoning the Carlton every 10 minutes trying to get you. You see, the summertime number flopped on the second night, and they hadn't anything to put in its place. But it's all right. They took it out and sewed up the wound, and now you'd never know there'd been anything wrong. The show was 10 minutes too long, anyway.
How's the show going?
It's a riot. They think it will run 2 years in London. As far as I can make it out, you don't call it a success in London unless you can take your grandchildren to see the 1000th night.
That's splendid. And how is everybody? All right?
Fine. That fellow Grey is still hanging around Babe. It beats me what she sees in him. Anybody but an infant can see the man wasn't on the level. Well, I don't blame you for quitting London, George. This sort of thing is worth 50 Londons.
The procession had reached one of the upper rooms, and they were looking down from a window that had commanded a sweep of miles of the countryside, rolling and green and wooded. Far away, beyond the last covert, Belpher Bay gleamed like a streak of silver. Billie Dore gave a little sigh.
Oh, there's nothing like this in the world. I'd like to stand here for the rest of my life, just lapping it up.
I will call your attention, boomed Keggs at their elbow, to this window, known to the family tradition as Leonard's Leap, 1787, that Lord Leonard IV, eldest son of His Grace the Duke of Lochlin, hurled himself out of this window in order to avoid compromising the beautiful Countess of Marshmoreton, with whom he is related to have had an innocent romance. Surprised at an advanced hour by his lordship, the earl, and her ladyship's boudoir, as this room then was, he leaped through the open window into the boughs of the cedar tree, which stands below, and was fortunate enough to escape with a few harmless contusions. A murmur of admiration greeted the recital of the ready tact of this 18th-century Steve Brodie.
"There," said Billy enthusiastically, "that's exactly what I mean about this country. It's just a mass of Leonard's Leaps and things. I'd like to settle down in this sort of a place and spend the rest of my life milking cows and taking forkfuls of soup to the deserving villagers."
"We will now," said Keggs, herding the mob with a gesture, "proceed to the amber drawing-room, containing some Gobelin tapestries, highly spoken of by connoisseurs."
The obedient mob began to drift out in his wake.
"What do you say, George?" asked Billy in an undertone. "If we sidestep the amber drawing-room, I'm wild to get into that garden. There's a man working among those roses. Maybe he would show us around."
George followed her, pointing finger. Just below them, a sturdy, brown-faced man in corduroys was pausing to light a stubby pipe.
"Just as you like."
They made their way down the great staircase. The voice of Keggs, saying complimentary things about the Gobelin tapestries, came to their ears like the roll of distant drums. They wandered out towards the rose garden. The man in corduroys had lit his pipe and was bending once more to his task.
"Well, Dada," said Billy amiably, "how are the crops?"
The man straightened himself. He was a nice-looking man of middle age, with the kind eyes of a friendly dog. He smiled genially and started to put his pipe away. Billy stopped him.
"Oh, don't stop smoking on my account," she said. "I like it." "Well, you've got the right sort of job, haven't you? If I was a man, there's nothing I'd like better than to put in my 8 hours in a rose garden."
She looked about her. "And this," she said with approval, "is just what a rose garden ought to be."
"Are you fond of roses, missy?"
"You bet I am. You must have every kind here that was ever invented. All 57 varieties."
"There are nearly 3,000 varieties," said the man in corduroys tolerantly.
"I was speaking colloquially, Dada. You can't teach me anything about roses. I'm the guy that invented them. Got any Ayrshires?" The man in corduroy seemed to have come to the conclusion that Billie was the only thing on earth that mattered. This revelation of a kindred spirit had captured him completely. George was merely among those present. Them over there are Ayrshires, missy. We don't get Ayrshires in America. At least, I never ran across them. I suppose they do have them. You want the right soil. Clay and lots of rain. You're right. There was an earnest expression on Billy Dore's face that George had never seen there before. Say, listen, Dada, in this manner of rose beetles, what would you do if... George moved away. The conversation was becoming too technical for him, and he had an idea that he would not be missed. There had come to him, moreover, in a flash, one of those sudden inspirations which great generals get. He had visited the castle this afternoon without any settled plan, other than a vague hope that he might somehow see Maud. He now perceived that there was no chance of doing this. Evidently, on Thursdays, the family went to Earth and remained hidden until the sightseers had gone. But there was another avenue of communication open to him. This gardener seemed an exceptionally intelligent man. He could be trusted to deliver a note to Maud. In his late rambles about Belpher Castle, in the company of Keggs and his followers, George had been privileged to inspect the library. It was an easily accessible room, opening off the main hall. He left Billy and her new friend deep in a discussion of slugs and plant lice, and walked quickly back to the house. The library was unoccupied. George was a thorough young man. He believed in leaving nothing to chance. The gardener had seemed a trustworthy soul, but you never knew. It was possible that he drank. He might forget or lose the precious note. So, with a wary eye on the door, George hastily scribbled it in duplicate. This took him but a few minutes. He went out into the garden again to find Billy Dore on the point of stepping into a blue automobile. "Oh, there you are, George. I wondered where you had got to. Say, I made quite a hit with Dada. I've given him my address, and he's promised to send me a whole lot of roses. By the way, shake hands with Mr. Forsyth. This is George Bevan, Freddy, who wrote the music for our show." The solemn youth at the wheel extended a hand. "Topping show. Topping music. Topping all round." "Well, goodbye, George. See you soon, I suppose?" "Oh, yes, give my love to everybody." "All right. Let her rip, Freddy. Goodbye."
"Bye."
The blue car gathered speed and vanished down the drive. George returned to the man in the corduroys, who had bent himself double in pursuit of a slug.
"Just a minute," said George hurriedly. He pulled out the first of the notes. "Give this to Lady Maud on the first chance you get. It's important. Here's a sovereign for your trouble."
He hastened away. He noticed that gratification had turned the other nearly purple in the face, and was anxious to leave him. He was a modest young man, and effusive thanks always embarrassed him. There now remained the disposal of the duplicate note. It was hardly worth while, perhaps, taking such a precaution, but George knew that victories are won by those who take no chances. He had wandered, perhaps, 100 yards from the rose garden when he encountered a small boy in the many-buttoned uniform of a page. The boy had appeared from behind a big cedar, where, as a matter of fact, he had been smoking a stolen cigarette. "Do you want to earn half a crown?" asked George. The market value of messengers had slumped. The stripling held his hand out. "Give this note to Lady Maud."
"Right-ho!"
"See that it reaches her at once." George walked off with the consciousness of a good day's work done. Albert, the page, having bitten his half-crown, placed it in his pocket. Then he hurried away, a look of excitement and gratification in his deep blue eyes. End of chapter 8.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Yas Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Woodhouse. Chapter 9. While George and Billy Dore wandered to the rose garden to interview the man in corduroys, Maud had been seated not 100 yards away, in a very special haunt of her own, a cracked stucco temple set up in the days of the Regency on the shores of a little lily-covered pond. She was reading poetry to Albert the page. She had interested herself in him some 2 months back, in much the same spirit as the prisoner in his dungeon cell tames and pets the conventional mouse. To educate Albert, to raise him above his groove in life and develop his soul, appealed to her romantic nature as a worthy task, and as a good way of filling in the time. It is an exceedingly moot point, and one which his associates of the servants' hall would have combated hotly, whether Albert possessed a soul.
The most one could say for certain is that he looked as if he possessed one. To one who saw his deep blue eyes and their sweet pensive expression as they searched the middle distance, he seemed like a young angel. How was the watcher to know that the thought behind that far-off gaze was simply a speculation as to whether the bird on the cedar tree was or was not within range of his catapult? Certainly, Maud had no such suspicion. She worked hopefully day by day to rouse Albert to an appreciation of the nobler things of life. Not but what it was a tough going. Even she admitted that. Albert's soul did not soar readily. It refused to leap from the earth. His reception of the poem she was reading could scarcely have been called encouraging. Maud finished it in a hushed voice, and looked pensively across the dappled water of the pool. A gentle breeze stirred the water-lilies, so that they seemed to sigh. "Isn't that beautiful, Albert?" she said. Albert's blue eyes lit up. His lips parted eagerly. "That's the first hornet I've seen this year," he said, pointing. Maud felt a little dampened. "Haven't you been listening, Albert?"
"Oh, yes, my lady. Ain't he a whopper, too?"
"Never mind the hornet, Albert. Very good, my lady." "I wish you wouldn't say, 'very good, m'lady.' It's like—" She paused. She had been about to say that it was like a butler, but, she reflected regretfully, it was probably Albert's dearest ambition to be like a butler. "It doesn't sound right. Just say, 'yes.'"
"Yes, m'lady."
Maud was not enthusiastic about the m'lady, but she let it go. After all, she had not quite settled in her own mind what exactly she wished Albert's attitude toward herself to be. Broadly speaking, she wanted him to be as like as he could to a medieval page, one of those silk and satined little treasures she had read about in the Ingoldsby legends. And, of course, they presumably said, "my lady." And yet, she felt, not for the first time, that it is not easy to revive the Middle Ages in these curious days. Pages, like other things, seemed to have changed since then. "That poem was written by a very clever man who married one of my ancestresses. He ran away with her from this very castle in the 17th century."
"Law,"
said Albert as a concession, but he was still interested in the hornet. He was far below her in the eyes of the world, but she knew what a wonderful man he was, so she didn't mind what people said about her marrying beneath her.
"Like Susan when she married the policeman?"
"Who was Susan?"
"Red-headed girl that used to be the cook here. Mr. Kegg says to her, he says, 'You're marrying beneath you, Susan,' he says. I heard him. I was listening at the door. And she says to him, she says, 'Oh, go and boil your fat head,' she says."
This translation of a favourite romance into terms of the servants' hall chilled Maud like a cold shower. She recoiled from it.
"Wouldn't you like to get a good education, Albert?" she said, perseveringly, "and become a great poet and write wonderful poems?"
Albert considered the point and shook his head.
"No, m'lady."
It was discouraging. But Maud was a girl of pluck. You cannot leap into strange cabs in Piccadilly unless you have pluck. She picked up another book from the stone seat.
"Read me some of this," she said, "and then tell me if it doesn't make you feel you want to go and do big things."
Albert took the book cautiously. He was getting a little fed up with all this sort of thing. True, her ladyship gave him chocolates to eat during these sessions, but for all that it was too much like school for his taste. He regarded the open page with disfavour.
"Go on," said Maud, closing her eyes. "It's very beautiful."
Albert began. He had a husky voice, due, it is to be feared, to precocious cigarette smoking, and his enunciation was not as good as it might have been.
"With blackest moors, the flower ports were, crusted one and all. Their rusted niles fell from the knots that held the pier to the garden wall. Their broken sheds looked sad and strange. Unlifted was the clinking latch, weeded and worn their ancient thatch upon their lonely moated grange. She only said, 'Me life is dreary. "'He cometh not,' she said. Albert rather liked this part. He was never happy in narrative unless it could be sprinkled with a plentiful supply of he saids and she saids. He finished with some gusto. She said, "I am a weary. I would that I was dead."
Maud had listened to this rendition of one of her most adored poems with much the same feeling which a composer with an oversensitive ear would suffer on hearing his pet opus assassinated by a schoolgirl. Albert, who was a willing lad and prepared, if such should be her desire, to plough his way through the entire 7 stanzas, began the 2nd verse, but Maud gently took the book away from him. Enough was sufficient.
"Now wouldn't you like to be able to write a wonderful thing like that, Albert?"
"Not me, my lady."
"You wouldn't like to be a poet when you grew up?"
Albert shook his golden head. "I want to be a butcher when I grow up, my lady."
Maud uttered a little cry. "A butcher?"
"Yes, my lady. Butchers earn good money," he said, a light of enthusiasm in his blue eyes, for he was now on his favourite subject. "You've got to have meat, you see, my lady. 'Tain't like poetry, my lady, which no one wants."
"But Albert," cried Maud faintly, "killing poor animals. Surely you wouldn't like that?"
Albert's eyes glowed softly, as might an acolyte's, at the sight of the censer.
"Mr. Wigton down at the home farm," he murmured reverently. "He says if I'm a good boy, he'll let me watch him kill a pig Tuesday."
He gazed out over the water lilies, his thoughts far away. Maud shuddered. She wondered if medieval pages were ever quite as earthy as this. "Perhaps you had better go now, Albert. They may be needing you in the house."
"Very good, my lady."
Albert rose, not unwilling to call it a day. He was conscious of the need for a quiet cigarette. He was fond of Maud, but a man can't spend all his time with the women.
"Pigs squeal like billy-o, my lady," he observed by way of adding a parting treasure to Maud's stock of general knowledge. "Oh, hear 'em a mile off, you can."
Maud remained where she was, thinking, a wistful figure. Tennyson's Mariana always made her wistful, even when rendered by Albert. In the occasional moods of sentimental depression, which came to vary her normal cheerfulness, it seemed to her that the poem might have been written with a prophetic eye to her special case, so nearly did it crystallize in magic words her own story. With blackest moss, the flower pots were thickly crusted, one and all. Well, no, not that particular part, perhaps. If he had found so much as one flower pot of his even thinly crusted with any foreign substance, Lord Marshmoreton would have gone through the place like an east wind, dismissing gardeners and undergardeners with every breath. But she only said, "My life is dreary. He cometh not," she said. She said, "I am a weary. I would that I were dead." How exactly at these moments when she was not out on the links, picking them off with turf with a mid-iron, or engaged in one of those other healthful sports which tend to take the mind off its troubles, those words summed up her case. Why didn't Geoffrey come? Or at least write? She could not write to him. Letters from the castle left only by way of the castle post-bag, which Rogers, the chauffeur, took down to the village every evening. Impossible to entrust the kind of letter she wished to write to any mode of delivery so public, especially now, when her movements were watched. To open and read another's letters is a low and dastardly act, but she believed that Lady Caroline would do it like a shot. She longed to pour out her heart to Geoffrey in a long, intimate letter, but she did not dare to take the risk of writing for a wider public. Things were bad enough as it was, after that disastrous sortie to London. At this point, a soothing vision came to her, the vision of George Bevan knocking off her brother Percy's hat. It was the only pleasant thing that had happened almost as far back as she could remember. And then, for the first time, her mind condescended to dwell for a moment on the author of that act, George Bevan, the friend in need, whom she had met only the day before in the lane. What was George doing at Belpher?
His presence there was significant, and his words even more so. He had stated explicitly that he wished to help her. She found herself oppressed by the irony of things. A knight had come to the rescue, but the wrong knight. Why could it not have been Geoffrey who waited in ambush outside the castle, and not a pleasant but negligible stranger? Whether, deep down in her consciousness, she was aware of a fleeting sense of disappointment in Geoffrey, a swiftly passing thought that he had failed her, she could hardly have said, so quickly did she crush it down. She pondered on the arrival of George. What was the use of his being somewhere in the neighbourhood if she had no means of knowing where she could find him? Situated as she was, she could not wander at will about the countryside looking for him. And even if she found him, what then? There was not much that any stranger, however pleasant, could do. She flushed at a sudden thought. Of course, there was something George could do for her, if he were willing. He could receive, dispatch, and deliver letters. If only she could get in touch with him, she could, through him, get in touch with Geoffrey. The whole world changed for her. The sun was setting, and chill little winds had begun to stir the lily pads, giving a depressing air to the scene. But to Maud it seemed as if all nature smiled. With the egotism of love, she did not perceive that what she had proposed to ask George to do was practically to fulfil the humble role of the hollow tree in which lovers dump letters, to be extracted later. She did not consider George's feelings at all. He had offered to help her, and this was his job. The world is full of Georges, whose task it is to hang about in the background and make themselves unobtrusively useful. She had reached this conclusion when Albert, who had taken a short cut the more rapidly to accomplish his errand, burst upon her dramatically from the heart of a rhododendron thicket. "M'lady, gentlemen give me this to give you." Maud read the note. It was brief and to the point. "I am staying near the castle at a cottage they call the one down by Platt's. It is a rather new, red-brick place. You can easily find it. I shall be waiting there if you want me." It was signed, "The Man in the Cab." "Do you know a cottage called the one down by Platt's, Albert?" asked Maud. "Yes, m'lady. It's down by Platt's farm. I see a chicken killed there Wednesday week. Do you know, m'lady, after a chicken's head is cut off, it goes running lickety-split?" Maud shivered slightly. Albert's fresh young enthusiasms frequently jarred upon her. "I find a friend of mine is staying there. I want you to take a note to him from me." "Very good, m'lady." "And Albert?" "Yes, m'lady?" "Perhaps it would be as well if you said nothing about this to any one of your friends." In Lord Marshmoreton's study, a council of three was sitting in debate. The subject under discussion was that other note which George had written and so ill-advisedly entrusted to one whom he had taken for a guileless gardener. The council consisted of Lord Marshmoreton, looking rather shamefaced, his son, Percy, looking swollen and serious, and Lady Caroline Byng, looking like a tragedy queen.
"This," Lord Belpher was saying in a determined voice, "settles it. From now on, Maud must not be allowed out of our sight."
Lord Marshmoreton spoke.
"I rather wish," he said regretfully, "I hadn't spoken about the note. I only mentioned it because I thought you might think it amusing."
"Amusing!" Lady Caroline's voice shook the furniture.
"Amusing that the fellow should have handed me, of all people, a letter for Maud," exclaimed her brother. "I don't want to get Maud into trouble."
"You are criminally weak," said Lady Caroline severely. "I really, honestly believe that you are capable of giving the note to that poor, misguided girl and saying nothing about it." She flushed. "The insolence of the man, coming here and settling down at the very gates of the castle! If it was anybody but this man Platt who was giving him shelter, I should insist on his being turned out. But that man Platt would be only too glad to know that he is causing us annoyance."
"Quite," said Lord Belpher.
"You must go to this man as soon as possible," continued Lady Caroline, fixing her brother with a commanding stare, "and do your best to make him see how abominable his behaviour is."
"Oh, I couldn't," pleaded the Earl. I don't know the fellow. He'd throw me out. Nonsense! Go at the very earliest opportunity. Oh, all right, all right. Well, I think I'll be slipping out to the rose garden now. There's a clear hour before dinner.
There was a tap at the door. Alice Faraday entered bearing papers, a smile of sweet helpfulness on her pretty face.
I hoped I should find you here, Lord Marshmoreton. You promised to go over these notes with me, the ones about the Essex branch.
The hunted peer looked as if he were about to dive through the window.
Some other time, some other time. I have important matters.
Oh, if you're busy.
Of course, Lord Marshmoreton will be delighted to work on your notes, Miss Faraday, said Lady Caroline crisply. Take this chair, we are just going.
Lord Marshmoreton gave one wistful glance through the open window. Then he sat down with a sigh and felt for his reading glasses. End of chapter 9.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse, as read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk, www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 10. Your true golfer is a man who, knowing that life is short and perfection hard to attain, neglects no opportunity of practising his chosen sport, allowing neither wind, nor weather, nor any external influence to keep him from it. There is a story, with an excellent moral lesson, of a golfer whose wife had determined to leave him for ever. "Will nothing alter your decision?" he says. "Will nothing induce you to stay? Well then, while you are packing, I think I'll go out on the lawn and rub up my putting a bit." George Bevan was of this turn of mind. He might be in love, romance might have sealed him for her own, but that was no reason for blinding himself to the fact that his long game was bound to suffer if he neglected to keep himself up to the mark. His first act on arriving at Belpher Village had been to ascertain whether there was a lynx in the neighbourhood, and thither, on the morning after his visit to the castle and the delivery of the two notes, he repaired. At the hour of the day which he had selected, the clubhouse was empty, and he had just resigned himself to a solitary game, when, with a whir and a rattle, a grey racing car drove up, and from it emerged the same long young man whom, a couple days earlier, he had seen wriggle out from underneath the same machine. It was Reggie Byng's habit, also, not to allow anything, even love, to interfere with golf, and not even the prospect of hanging about the castle grounds in the hope of catching a glimpse of Alice Faraday and exchanging timorous words with her had been enough to keep him from the links. Reggie surveyed George with a friendly eye. He had a dim recollection of having seen him before, somewhere, at some time or other, and Reggie had the pleasing disposition which caused him to rank anybody whom he had seen somewhere at some time or other as a bosom friend. "Hullo, hullo, hullo," he observed. "Good morning," said George. "Waiting for somebody?" "No. How about it, then? Shall we stagger forth?" Delighted. George found himself speculating upon Reggie. He was unable to place him. That he was a friend of Maud, he knew, and guessed that he was also a resident of the castle. He would have liked to question Reggie, to probe him, to collect from him inside information as to the progress of events within the castle walls, but it is a peculiarity of golf, as of love, that it temporarily changes the natures of its victims, and Reggie, a confirmed babbler off the links, became, while in action, a stern, silent, intent person, his whole being centred on the game. With the exception of a casual remark of a technical nature when he met George on the various tees, and an occasional expletive when things went wrong with his ball, he eschewed conversation. It was not till the end of the round that he became himself again. "If I'd known you were such hot stuff," he declared generously, as George holed his 18th putt from a distance of 10 feet, "I'd have got you to give me a stroke or two." "I was on my game today," said George modestly. "Sometimes I slice as if I were cutting bread and can't putt to hit a haystack. Let me know when one of those times comes along and I'll take you on again. I don't know when I've seen anything fruitier than that way you got out of the bunker at the 15th. It reminded me of a match I saw between..." Reggie became technical. At the end of his observations, he climbed into the grey car. "Can I drop you anywhere?" "Thanks," said George, "if it's not taking you out of your way. I'm staying at Belpher Castle." "I live quite near there. Perhaps you'd care to come in and have a drink on your way?" "A ripe scheme," agreed Reggie.
10 minutes in the grey car ate up the distance between the links and George's cottage. Reggie Byng passed these minutes, in the intervals of eluding carts and foiling the apparently suicidal intentions of some stray fowls, in jerky conversation on the subject of his iron shots, with which he expressed deep satisfaction. "Topping little place, absolutely," was the verdict he pronounced on the exterior of the cottage as he followed George in. "I've often thought it would be a rather sound scheme to settle down in this sort of shanty and keep chickens and grow a honey-coloured beard and have soup and jelly brought to you by the vicar's wife and so forth. Nothing to worry you then. Do you live all alone here?" George was busy squirting seltzer into his guest's glass. "Yes. Mrs. Platt comes in and cooks for me. The farmer's wife next door." An exclamation from the other caused him to look up. Reggie Byng was staring about him wide-eyed. "Great Scott! Mrs. Platt! Then you're the chappie!" George found himself unequal to the intellectual pressure of the conversation. "The chappie? The chappie there's all a row about. The mater was telling me only this morning that you lived here." "Is there a row about me?" "Is there a what?" Reggie's manner became solicitous. "I say, my dear old sportsman, I don't want to be the bearer of bad tidings and what not, if you know what I mean, but didn't you know there was a certain amount of angry passion rising and so forth because of you? At the castle, I mean. I don't want to seem to be discussing your private affairs and all that sort of thing, but what I mean is, well, you don't expect you can come charging in the way you have without touching the family on the raw a bit. The daughter of the house falls in love with you. The son of the house languishes in the chokey because he has a row with you in Piccadilly, and on top of all that you come here and camp out at the castle gates. Naturally, the family are a bit peeved. Only naturally, I mean to say. What?" George listened to this address in bewilderment. Maud in love with him? It sounded incredible. That he should love her after their one meeting was a different thing altogether. That was perfectly natural and in order. But that he should have had the incredible luck to win her affection, the thing struck him as grotesque and ridiculous. "In love with me?" he cried. "What on earth do you mean?" Reggie's bewilderment equalled his own. "Well, dash it all, old top, it surely isn't news to you. She must have told you. Why, she told me." "Told you? Am I going mad?" "Absolutely. I mean, absolutely not. Look here." Reggie hesitated. The subject was delicate, but once started, it might as well be proceeded with to some conclusion. A fellow couldn't go on talking about his iron shots after this, just as if nothing had happened. This was the time for the laying down of cards, the opening of hearts. "I say, you know," he went on, feeling his way, "you'll probably think it deuced rummy of me talking like this. Perfect stranger and what not. We don't even know each other's names." "Mine's Bevan, if that'll be any help." "Thanks very much, old chap. Great help. Mine's Byng. Reggie Byng. Well, as we're all pals here and the meeting's tiled and so forth, I'll start by saying that the mater is most deucedly set on my marrying Lady Maud. Been pals all our lives, you know. Children together and all that sort of rot. Now, there's nobody I think of a more corking sportsman than Maud, if you know what I mean. But this is where the catch comes in. I'm most frightfully in love with somebody else. Hopeless and all that sort of thing. But still, there it is. And all the while the mater behind me with a bradawl sticking me on to propose to Maud, who wouldn't have me if I were the only fellow on earth. You can't imagine, my dear old chap, what a relief it was to both of us when she told me the other day that she was in love with you, and wouldn't dream of looking at anybody else. I tell you, I went singing about the place." George felt inclined to imitate his excellent example. A burst of song was the only adequate expression of the mood of heavenly happiness which this young man's revelations had brought upon him. The whole world seemed indifferent. Wings seemed to sprout from Reggie's shapely shoulders. The air was filled with soft music. Even the wallpaper seemed moderately attractive. He mixed himself a second whiskey and soda. It was the next best thing to singing. "I see," he said. It was difficult to say anything. Reggie was regarding him enviously. "Wish I knew how the deuce fellows set about making a girl fall in love with them. Other chappies seem to do it, but I can't even start. She seems to sort of gaze through me, don't you know? She kind of looks at me as if I were more to be pitied than censured, but as if she thought I really ought to do something about it. Of course, she's a devilish brainy girl, and I'm a fearful chump. Makes it kind of hopeless, what?" George, in his newborn happiness, found a pleasure in encouraging a less lucky mortal. "Not a bit. What you ought to do is to..." "Yes?" said Reggie eagerly. George shook his head. "No, I don't know." "Nor do I, dash it," said Reggie. George pondered. "It seems to me it's purely a question of luck. Either you're lucky or you're not. Look at me, for instance. What is there about me to make a wonderful girl fall in love with me?" "Nothing. I see what you mean. At least, what I mean to say is..." "No, you're right the first time. It's all a question of luck. There's nothing anyone can do." "I hang about a good deal and get in her way," said Reggie. "She's always tripping over me. I thought that might help a bit. It might, of course. But, on the other hand, when we do meet, I can't think of anything to say. Oh, that's bad. Just funny thing. I'm not what you'd call a silent sort of chappy by nature, but when I'm with her, I don't know. It's rum. He drained his glass and rose. Well, I suppose I may as well be staggering. Don't give up. Have another game one of these days, what? Splendid, any time you like. Well, so long. Goodbye. George gave himself up to glowing thoughts. For the first time in his life, he seemed to be vividly aware of his own existence. It was as if he were some newly created thing. Everything around him and everything he did had taken on a strange and novel interest. He seemed to notice the ticking of the clock for the first time. When he raised his glass, the action had a curious air of newness. All his senses were oddly alert. He could even... How would it be, inquired Reggie, appearing in the doorway like part of a conjuring trick, if I gave her a flower or two every now and then? Just thought of it as I was starting the car. She's fond of flowers. Fine, said George heartily. He had not heard a word. The alertness of sense which had come to him was accompanied by a strange inability to attend to other people's speech. This would no doubt pass, but meanwhile it made him a poor listener. Well, it's worth trying, said Reggie. I'll give it a whirl. Toodle-doo. Bye. Pip, pip. Reggie withdrew, and presently came the noise of the car starting. George returned to his thoughts. Time, as we understand it, ceases to exist for a man in such circumstances. Whether it was a minute later or several hours, George did not know, but presently he was aware of a small boy standing beside him, a golden-haired boy, with blue eyes, who wore the uniform of a page. He came out of his trance. This, he recognized, was the boy to whom he had given the note for Maud. He was different from any other intruder. He meant something in George's scheme of things. "Hullo," said the youth. "Hullo, Alfonso," said George. "My name's not Alfonso. Well, you be very careful, or it soon may be. Got a note for you from Lady Maud." "You'll find some cake and ginger ale in the kitchen," said the grateful George. "Give it a trial." "Not arf," said the stripling. End of chapter 10.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Chapter 11 of A Damsel in Distress, read by Aspistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. George opened the letter with trembling and reverent fingers. "Dear Mr. Bevan, thank you ever so much for your note, which Albert gave to me. How very, very kind."
"Aye, mister."
George looked up testily. The boy Albert had reappeared.
"What's the matter? Can't you find the cake?" "I found the cake," rejoined Albert, adducing proof of the statement in the shape of a massive slice, from which he took a substantial bite to assist thought. "But I can't find the ginger ale."
George waved him away. This interruption at such a moment was annoying. "Look for it, child, look for it, sniff after it, bay on its trail. It's somewhere about."
"Right," mumbled Albert through the cake.
He flicked a crumb off his cheek with a tongue which would have excited the friendly interest of an anteater.
"I like ginger ale."
"Well, go and bathe in it."
"Right."
George returned to his letter. "Dear Mr. Bevan, thank you ever so much for your note, which Albert gave to me. How very, very kind of you to come here like this, and to say..."
"Hi, mister!"
"Good heavens!" George glared. "What's the matter now? Haven't you found that ginger ale yet?"
"I found the ginger ale right enough, but I can't find the thing."
"The thing? What thing?"
"The thing! The thing what you open ginger ale with!"
"Oh, you mean the thing! It's in the middle drawer of the dresser. Use your eyes, my boy."
"Right."
George gave an overwrought sigh and began the letter again. "Dear Mr. Bevan, thank you ever so much for your note, which Albert gave to me. How very, very kind of you to come here like this, and to say that you would help me. And how clever of you to find me after I was so secretive that day in the cab. You really can help me, if you are willing. It is too long to explain in a note, but I am in great trouble, and there is nobody except you to help me. I will explain everything when I see you. The difficulty will be to slip away from home, They are watching me every moment, I'm afraid. But I will try my hardest to see you very soon. Yours sincerely, Maud Marsh. Just for a moment, it must be confessed, the tone of the letter dampened George. He could not have said just what he had expected, but certainly Reggie's revelations had prepared him for something rather warmer, something more in the style in which a girl would write to the man she loved. The next moment, however, he saw how foolish any such expectation had been. How on earth could any reasonable man expect a girl to let herself go at this stage of the proceedings? It was for him to make the first move. Naturally, she wasn't going to reveal her feelings until he had revealed his. George raised the letter to his lips and kissed it vigorously. "Hi, mister!" George started guiltily. The blush of shame overspread his cheeks. The room seemed to echo with the sound of that fatuous kiss. "Kitty, kitty, kitty," he called, snapping his fingers and repeating the incriminating noise. "I was just calling my cat," he explained with dignity. "You didn't see her in there, did you?" Albert's blue eyes met his in a derisive stare. The lid of the left one fluttered. It was but too plain that Albert was not convinced. "A little black cat with white shirt front," babbled George perseveringly. "She's usually either here or there or somewhere. Kitty, kitty, kitty." The cupid's bow of Albert's mouth parted. He uttered one word. "Swank." There was a tense silence. What Albert was thinking, one cannot say. The thoughts of youth are long, long thoughts. What George was thinking was that the late King Herod had been unjustly blamed for a policy which had been both statesmanlike and in the interests of the public. He was blaming the mawkish sentimentality of the modern legal system which ranks the evisceration and secret burial of small boys as a crime. "What do you mean?" "You know what I mean." "I've a good mind to—" Albert waved a deprecating hand. "It's all right, mister. I'm your friend." "You are you? Well, don't let it about. I've got a reputation to keep up."
"I'm your friend, I tell you. I can help you. I want to help you."
George's views on infanticide underwent a slight modification. After all, he felt, much must be excused to youth. Youth thinks it funny to see a man kissing a letter. It is not funny, of course. It is beautiful. But it's no good arguing the point. Let youth have its snigger, provided after it has finished sniggering it intends to buckle to and be of practical assistance. Albert, as an ally, was not to be despised. George did not know what Albert's duties as a page-boy were, but they seemed to be of a nature that gave him plenty of leisure and freedom, and a friendly resident of the castle with leisure and freedom was just what he needed. "That's very good of you," he said, twisting his reluctant features into a fairly benevolent smile.
"Well, I can help," persisted Albert. "Got a cigarette?"
"Do you smoke, child?"
"When I get hold of a cigarette, I do."
"I'm sorry, I can't oblige you. I don't smoke cigarettes."
"Then I'll have to have one of my own," said Albert moodily.
He reached into the mysteries of his pocket and produced a piece of string, a knife, the wishbone of a fowl, two marbles, a crushed cigarette, and a match. Replacing the string, the knife, the wishbone, and the marbles, he ignited the match against the tightest part of his person and lit the cigarette.
"Oh, I can help you. I know the ropes."
"And smoke them," said George, wincing.
"Pardon?"
"Nothing." Albert took an enjoyable whiff.
"Ah, I know all about you."
"You do?"
"You and Liddy Maud."
"Oh, you do you?"
"I was listening at the keyhole when the row was going on."
"There was a row, was there?" A faint smile of retrospective enjoyment lit up Albert's face.
"An awful row. Shouting and yelling and cussing all over the shop. About you and Liddy Maud."
"And you drank it in, eh?"
"Pardon?"
"I say you listened?"
"Not half I listened. Seeing I'd just drawn you in a sweepstike, of course I listened. Not half."
George did not follow him here.
"The sweepstike? What's a sweepstike?" "Why, a thing you puts names in hats and draws 'em, and the one that gets the winning name wins the money."
"Oh, you mean a sweepstake?"
"That's what I said, a sweepstake."
George was still puzzled.
"But I don't understand. How do you mean you drew me in a sweepstake? I mean a sweepstake.
What sweepstake?"
"Down in the servants' hall. Keggs, the butler, started it. I heard him say he always had one every place he was as a butler. Leastways, whenever there was any daughters of the house. There's always a chance, when there's a house party, of one of the daughters of the house getting married to one of the gents in the party. So Keggs, he puts all of the gents' names in the hat, and you pay 5 shillings for a chance, and the one that draws the winning name gets the money. And if the daughter of the house don't get married that time, the money's put away and added to the pool for the next house party."
George gasped. This revelation of life below stairs in the stately homes of England took his breath away. Then astonishment gave way to indignation. "Do you mean to tell me that you, you worms, made Lady Maud the prize of a sweepstake?" Albert was hurt.
"Who are you calling worms?"
George perceived the need of diplomacy. After all, much depended on this child's goodwill. "I was referring to the butler. What's his name? Keggs."
"He ain't a worm. He's a serpent."
Albert drew at his cigarette. His brow darkened.
"He does the drawing, Keggs does, and I'd like to know how it is he always manages to cop the favourite."
Albert chuckled.
"But this time I'd done him proper. He didn't want me in the thing at all. Said I was too young. Tried to do the drawing without me. Clip that boy one side of the head, he says, and turn him out, he says. I says, yes, you will, I says. And what price me going to his lordship in blowing the gaff, I says. He says, oh, all right, he says. Have it your own way, he says. Where's your 5 shillings, he says. Here you are, I says. Oh, very well, he says. But you'll have to draw last, he says, being the youngest. Well, they started drawing the names, and of course Keggs asked to draw Mr. Bing.
Oh, he drew Mr. Bing, did he?
Yes. And everyone knew Reggie was the favourite. Smiled all over his fat face, the old serpent did. And when it come to my turn, he says to me, 'Sorry, Elbert,' he says, 'but there ain't no more names. They've give out.' 'Oh, they have they?' I says. 'Well, what's the matter with giving a fellow a sporting chance?' I says. 'How do you mean?' he says. 'Why, write me out a ticket marked Mr. X,' I says. 'Then if her ladyship marries anyone not in the house party, I cop.' 'All right,' he says, 'but you know the conditions of this here sweep. Nothing don't count, only what takes place during the 2 weeks of the house party,' he says. 'All right,' I says. 'Write me ticket. It's a fair sporting venture.' So he writes me out me ticket, with Mr. X on it. And I says to him all, I says, 'I'd like to have witnesses,' I says, 'to this here thing. Do all you gents agree that if anyone not in the house party, and whose name ain't on one of the other tickets, marries her ladyship, I get the pool?' I says. They all says, 'That's right.' And then I says to him all straight out, I says, 'I happen to know,' I says, 'that her ladyship is in love with a gent that's not in the house party at all. An American gent,' I says. They wouldn't believe it at first. But when Keggs had put 2 and 2 together, and thought of the 1 or 2 things that had happened, he turned as white as a sheet and said it was a swindle, and wanted the drawing done over again. But the other says, 'No,' they says, 'it's quite fair,' they says. And one of 'em offered me 10 bob slap out for my ticket. But I stuck to it, I did. And that," concluded Albert, throwing the cigarette into the fireplace just in time to prevent a scorched finger, "that's why I'm going to help you."
There is probably no attitude of mind harder for the average man to maintain than that of aloof disapproval. George was an average man, and during the degrading recital, just concluded, he had found himself slipping. At first he had been revolted, then, in spite of himself, amused, and now, when all the facts were before him, he could induce his mind to think of nothing else than his good fortune in securing as an ally one who appeared to combine a precocious intelligence with a helpful lack of scruple. War is war, and love is love,
and in each the practical man inclines to demand from his fellow-workers the punch rather than a lofty soul. A page-boy replete with the finer feelings would have been useless in this crisis. Albert, who seemed, on the evidence of a short but sufficient acquaintance, to be a lad who would not recognize the finer feelings if they were handed to him on a plate with watercress round them, promised to be invaluable. Something in his manner told George that the child was bursting with schemes for his benefit. "Have some more cake, Albert," he said ingratiatingly. The boy shook his head. "Do," urged George. "Just a little slice."
"There ain't no little slice," replied Albert with regret. "I've et it all," he sighed and resumed. "I got a scheme."
"Fine. What is it?" Albert knitted his brows.
"It's like this. You want to see her ladyship, but she can't come to the castle, and she can't come to you. Not with her fat brother dodging of her footsteps. That's it, ain't it? Or am I a liar?"
George hastened to reassure him.
"That is exactly it. What's the answer?" "I tell you what you can do. There's the big ball tonight, 'cause of its being his Nibs coming of age tomorrow. All the country'll be here."
"You think I could slip in and be taken for a guest?" Albert snorted contempt.
"No, I don't think nothing of the kind, not being a fathead,"
George apologized.
"But what you could do is this. I heard Keggs talking to the housekeeper about having to get a lot of tempy waiters to help out for the night."
George reached forward and patted Albert on the head.
"Don't mess my hair now," warned that youth coldly.
"Albert, you're one of the great thinkers of the age. I could get into the castle as a waiter, and you could tell Lady Maud I was there, and we could arrange a meeting. Machiavelli couldn't have thought of anything smoother."
"Mac who?"
"One of your ancestors. Great schemer in his day. But one moment."
"Now what?"
"How am I to get engaged? How do I get the job?"
"That's all right. I'll tell the housekeeper you're my cousin. Been a waiter in America at the best restaurants. Home for a holiday. But he'll come in one night to oblige. They'll pay you a quid."
"I'll hand it over to you." "Just," said Albert approvingly, "what I was going to suggest myself."
"Then I'll leave all the arrangements to you. You'd better, if you don't want to make a mess of everything. All you've got to do is come to the servants' entrance at 8 sharp tonight, and say you're my cousin."
"That's an awful thing to ask anyone to say."
"Pardon?"
"Nothing," said George. End of chapter 11.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P. G. Wodehouse, as read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk, www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 12. The great ball in honour of Lord Belpher's coming of age was at its height. The reporter of the Belpher Intelligencer, the farmer's guide, who was present in his official capacity, and had been allowed by Butler Keggs to take a peep at the scene through a side door, justly observed in his account of the proceedings next day that the tout ensemble was fairy-like, and described the company as a galaxy of fair women and brave men. The floor was crowded with all that was best and noblest in the county, so that a half-brick, hurled at any given moment, must infallibly have spilt blue blood. Peers stepped on the toes of knights, honourables bumped into the spines of baronets. Probably the only titled person in the whole of the surrounding country who was not playing his part in the glittering scene was Lord Marshmoreton, who, on discovering that his private study had been converted into a cloakroom, had retired to bed with a pipe and a copy of Roses Red and Roses White by Emily Ann McIntosh, Popgood, Crewley & Co., which he was to discover, after he was between the sheets and it was too late to repair the error, was not, as he had supposed, a treatise on his favourite hobby, but a novel of stearine sentimentality dealing with the adventures of a pure young English girl and an artist named Claude. George, from the shaded seclusion of a gallery, looked down upon the brilliant throng with impatience.
It seemed to him that he had been doing this all his life. The novelty of the experience had long since ceased to divert him. It was all just like the second act of an old-fashioned musical comedy. Act Two, the ballroom, Grantchester Towers, 1 week later. A resemblance which was heightened for him by the fact that the band had more than once played dead and buried melodies of his own composition, of which he had wearied a full 18 months back. A complete absence of obstacles had attended his intrusion into the castle. A brief interview with a motherly old lady, whom even Albert seemed to treat with respect, and who, it appeared, was Mrs. Digby, the housekeeper, followed by an even briefer encounter with Keggs, fussy and irritable with responsibility, and even, while talking to George, carrying on two other conversations on topics of the moment. And he was past the censures and free for one night only to add his presence to the chosen inside the walls of Belpher. His duties were to stand in this gallery, and, with the assistance of one of the maids, to minister to the comfort of such of the dancers as should use it as a sitting-out place. None had so far made their appearance, the superior attractions of the main floor having exercised a great appeal, and for the past hour George had been alone with the maid and his thoughts. The maid, having asked George if he knew her cousin Frank, who had been in America nearly a year, and having received a reply in the negative, seemed to be disappointed in him, and to lose interest, and had not spoken for 20 minutes. George scanned the approaches to the balcony for a sight of Albert, as a shipwrecked mariner scans the horizon for a passing sail. It was inevitable, he supposed, this waiting. It would be difficult for Maud to slip away, even for a moment, on such a night. "I say, laddie, would you mind getting me a lemonade?" George was gazing over the balcony when the voice spoke behind him, and the muscles of his back stiffened as he recognized its genial note. This was one of the things he had prepared himself for, but now that it had happened, he felt a wave of stage fright, such as he had only once experienced before in his life, on the occasion when he had been young enough and inexperienced enough to take a curtain call on a first night. Reggie Byng was friendly and would not wilfully betray him, but Reggie was also a babbler, who could not be trusted to keep things to himself. It was necessary, he perceived, to take a strong line from the start, and convince Reggie that any likeness which the latter might suppose that he detected between his companion of that afternoon and the waiter of tonight existed only in his heated imagination. As George turned, Reggie's face, pink with healthful exercise and Lord Marshmoreton's finest Bollinger, lost most of its colour. His eyes and mouth opened wider. The fact is, Reggie was shaken. All through the earlier part of the evening he had been sedulously priming himself with stimulants with the view of amassing enough nerve to propose to Alice Faraday, and now that he had drawn her away from the throng to this secluded nook and was about to put his fortune to the test, a horrible fear swept over him that he had overdone it. He was having optical illusions. "Good God!" Reggie loosened his collar and pulled himself together. "Would you mind taking a glass of lemonade to the lady in blue sitting on the settee over there by the statue?" he said carefully. He brightened up a little. Pretty good, that. Not absolutely a test sentence. Perhaps like truly rural or the intricacies of the British Constitution, but nevertheless no mean feat. "I say," he continued after a pause. "Sir?" "You haven't ever seen me before, by any chance? If you know what I mean, have you?" "No, sir." You haven't a brother or anything of that shape or order, have you? No? No, sir. I have often wished I had. I ought to have spoken to father about it. Father could never deny me anything." Reggie blinked. His misgiving returned. Either his ears, like his eyes, were playing him tricks, or else this waiter chappie was talking pure drivel. "What's that, sir? What did you say?" "I said, no, sir, I have no brother." "Didn't you say something else?" "No, sir." "What? No, sir." Reggie's worst suspicions were confirmed. "Good God!" he muttered. "Then I am." Miss Faraday, when he joined her on the settee, wanted an explanation. "What were you talking to that man about, Mr. Byng? You seem to be having a very interesting conversation."
"I was asking him if he had a brother."
Miss Faraday glanced quickly at him. She had had a feeling for some time during the evening that his manner had been strange.
"A brother? What made you ask him that?" What I mean is, he looked the sort of chap who might have a brother. Lots of those fellows have."
Alice Faraday's face took on a motherly look. She was fonder of Reggie than that love-sick youth supposed, and by sheer accident he had stumbled on the right road to her consideration. Alice Faraday was one of those girls whose dream it is to be the ministering angel to some chosen man, to be a good influence to him, and raise him to an appreciation of nobler things. Hitherto, Reggie's personality had seemed to her agreeable, but negative. A positive vice, like overindulgence in alcohol, altered him completely. It gave him a significance. "I told him to get you a lemonade," said Reggie. "He seems to be taking his time about it. Hi!" George approached deferentially. "Sir? Where's that lemonade?" "Lemonade, sir?" "Didn't I ask you to bring this lady a glass of lemonade?" "I did not understand you to, sir."
"But, great Scott, what were we chatting about, then?"
"You were telling me a diverting story about an Irishman who landed in New York looking for work, sir. You would like a glass of lemonade, sir?" "Very good, sir." Alice placed a hand gently on Reggie's arm. "Don't you think you had better lie down for a little and rest, Mr. Bing? I'm sure it would do you good." The solicitous note in her voice made Reggie quiver like a jelly. He had never known her to speak like that before. For a moment he was inclined to lay bare his soul, but his nerve was broken. He did not want her to mistake the outpouring of a strong man's heart for the irresponsible ravings of a too hearty dinner. It was one of life's ironies. Here he was, for the first time, all keyed up to go right ahead, and he couldn't do it. "It's the heat of the room," said Alice. "Shall we go and sit outside on the terrace? And never mind about the lemonade. I'm not really thirsty." Reggie followed her like a lamb. The prospect of the cool night air was grateful. "That," murmured George as he watched them depart, "ought to hold you for a while." He perceived Albert hastening towards him. End of chapter 12.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse. Read by Yaz Pistachio in Waxhaw, North Carolina. Chapter 13. Albert was in a hurry. He skimmed over the carpet like a water beetle. "Quick," he said. He cast a glance at the maid, George's co-worker. She was reading a novelette with her back turned. "Tell her you'll be back in 5 minutes," said Albert, jerking a thumb. "Unnecessary. She won't notice my absence. Ever since she discovered that I had never met her cousin Frank in America, I have meant nothing in her life." "Then come on." "Where?" "I'll show you." That it was not the nearest and most direct route which they took to the trysting place, George became aware after he had followed his young guide through doors and upstairs and downstairs, and had at last come to a halt in a room to which the sound of the music penetrated but faintly. He recognized the room. He had been in it before. It was the same room where he and Billy Dore had listened to Keggs telling the story of Lord Leonard and his leap. That window there, he remembered now, opened onto the very balcony from which the historic Leonard had done his spectacular dive. That it should be the scene of this other secret meeting struck George as appropriate. The coincidence appealed to him. Albert vanished. George took a deep breath. Now that the moment had arrived for which he had waited so long, he was aware of a return of that feeling of stage fright which had come upon him when he had heard Reggie Bing's voice. This sort of thing, it must be remembered, was not in George's usual line. His had been a quiet and uneventful life, and the only exciting thing which, in his recollection, had ever happened to him previous to the dramatic entry of Lady Maud into his taxicab, that day in Piccadilly, had occurred at college nearly 10 years before, when a festive roommate, no doubt with the best motives, had placed a Mexican horned toad in his bed on the night of the Yale football game. A light footstep sounded outside, and the room whirled round George in a manner which, if it had happened to Reggie Bing, would have caused that injudicious drinker to abandon the habits of a lifetime. When the furniture had returned to its place and the rug had ceased to spin, Maud was standing before him. Nothing is harder to remember than a once-seen face. It had caused George a good deal of distress and inconvenience that, try as he might, he could not conjure up anything more than a vague vision of what the only girl in the world really looked like. He had carried away with him from their meeting in the cab only a confused recollection of eyes that shone and a mouth that curved in a smile, and the brief moment in which he was able to refresh his memory when he found her in the lane with Reggie Bing and the broken-down car had not been enough to add definiteness. The consequence was that Maud came upon him now with the stunning effect of beauty seen for the first time. He gasped. In that dazzling ball dress, with the flush of dancing on her cheeks and the light of dancing in her eyes,
She was so much more wonderful than any picture of her which memory had been able to produce for his inspection that it was as if he had never seen her before. Even her brother, Percy, a stern critic where his nearest and dearest were concerned, had admitted on meeting her in the drawing-room before dinner that that particular dress suited Maud. It was a shimmering dream thing of rose leaves and moonbeams. That, at least, was how it struck George. A dressmaker would have found a longer and less romantic description for it. But that does not matter. Whoever wishes for a cold and technical catalogue of the stuffs which went to make up the picture that deprived George of speech may consult the files of the Belpher Intelligencer and Farmer's Guide, and read the report of the editor's wife, who does the dresses for the Intelligencer, under the pen name of Birdie Bright Eye. As far as George was concerned, the thing was made of rose leaves and moonbeams. George, as I say, was deprived of speech. That any girl could possibly look so beautiful was enough to paralyze his faculties. But that this ethereal being straight from fairyland could have stooped to love him, an earthly brute who wore sock suspenders and drank coffee for breakfast, that was what robbed George of the power to articulate. He could do nothing but look at her. From the hills of fairyland soft music came. Or, if we must be exact, Maud spoke. "I couldn't get away before." Then she stopped short and darted to the door, listening. "Was that somebody coming? I had to cut a dance with Mr. Plummer to get here, and I'm so afraid he may—" He had. A moment later it was only too evident that this was precisely what Mr. Plummer had done. There was a footstep on the stairs, a heavy footstep this time, and from outside the voice of the pursuer made itself heard. "Oh, there you are, Lady Maud. I was looking for you. This is our dance." George did not know who Mr. Plummer was. He did not want to know. His only thought regarding Mr. Plummer was a passionate realization of the superfluity of his existence. It is the presence on the globe of these Plummers that delays the coming of the millennium. His stunned mind leaped into sudden activity. He must not be found here, that was certain. Waiters who ramble at large about a feudal castle and are discovered in conversation with the daughter of the house excite comment. And, conversely, daughters of the house who talk in secluded rooms with waiters also find explanations necessary. He must withdraw. He must withdraw quickly. And, as a gesture from Maud indicated, the withdrawal must be effected through the French window opening on the balcony. Estimating the distance that separated him from the approaching Plummer at 3 stairs, the voice had come from below, and a landing, the space of time allotted to him by a hustling fate for disappearing was some 4 seconds. Inside 2½, the French window had opened and closed, and George was out under the stars, with the cool winds of the night playing on his heated forehead. He had now time for meditation. There are few situations which provide more scope for meditation than that of the man penned up on a small balcony a considerable distance from the ground, with his only avenue of retreat cut off behind him. So George meditated. First he mused on Plummer. He thought some hard thoughts about Plummer. Then he brooded on the unkindness of a fortune which had granted him the opportunity of this meeting with Maud, only to snatch it away almost before it had begun. He wondered how long the late Lord Leonard had been permitted to talk on that occasion, before he, too, had had to retire through these same windows. There was no doubt about one thing. Lovers who chose that room for their interviews seemed to have very little luck. It had not occurred to George at first that there could be any further disadvantage attached to his position, other than the obvious drawbacks which had already come to his notice. He was now to perceive that he had been mistaken. A voice was speaking in the room he had left, a plainly audible voice, deep and throaty, and within a moment George had become aware that he was to suffer the additional discomfort of being obliged to listen to a fellow man. One could call Plummer that, by stretching the facts a little, proposing marriage. The gruesomeness of the situation became intensified. Of all moments when a man, and justice compelled George to admit that Plummer was technically a human, of all moments when a man may, by all the laws of decency, demand to be alone without an audience of his own sex, the chiefest is the moment when he is asking a girl to marry him. George's was a sensitive nature, and he writhed at the thought of playing the eavesdropper at such a time. He looked frantically about him for a means of escape. Plummer had now reached the stage of saying at great length that he was not worthy of Maud. He said it over and over again in different ways. George was in hearty agreement with him, but he did not want to hear it. He wanted to get away. But how? Lord Leonard, on a similar occasion, had leaped. Some might argue, therefore, on the principle that what man has done, man can do, that George should have imitated him. But men differ. There was a man attached to a circus who used to dive off the roof of Madison Square Garden onto a sloping board, strike it with his chest, turn a couple of somersaults, reach the ground, bow 6 times, and go off to lunch. That sort of thing is a gift. Some of us have it, some have not. George had not. Painful as it was to hear Plummer floundering through his proposal of marriage, instinct told him that it would be far more painful to hurl himself out into mid-air, on the sporting chance of having his downward progress arrested by the branches of the big tree that had upheld Lord Leonard. No, there seemed nothing for it but to remain where he was. Inside the room, Plummer was now saying how much marriage would please his mother. "Psst!" George looked about him. It seemed to him that he had heard a voice. He listened. No, except for the barking of a distant dog, the faint wailing of a waltz, the rustle of a roosting bird, and the sound of Plummer saying that if her refusal was due to anything she may have heard about that breach of promise case of his a couple of years ago, he would like to state that he was more sinned against than sinning, and that the girl had absolutely misunderstood him. All was still.
"Psst! Aye, mister!"
It was a voice. It came from above. Was it an angel's voice? Not altogether. It was Albert's. The boy was leaning out of a window some 6 feet higher up the castle wall. George, his eyes by now grown used to the darkness, perceived that the stripling gesticulated as one having some message to impart. Then, glancing to one side, he saw what looked like some kind of a rope swayed against the wall. He reached for it. The thing was not a rope. It was a knotted sheet. From above came Albert's hoarse whisper.
"Look alive!"
This was precisely what George wanted to do for at least another 50 years or so, and it seemed to him, as he stood there in the starlight, gingerly fingering this flimsy linen thing, that if he were to suspend his 180 pounds of bone and sinew at the end of it, over the black gulf outside the balcony, he would look alive for about 5 seconds, and after that goodness only knew how he would look. He knew all about knotted sheets. He had read 100 stories in which heroes, heroines, low-comedy friends, and even villains did all sorts of reckless things with their assistance. There was not much comfort to be derived from that. It was one thing to read about people doing silly things like that, quite another to do them yourself. He gave Albert's sheet a tentative shake. In all his experience, he thought he had never come across anything so supremely unstable. One calls it Albert's sheet for the sake of convenience. It was really Reggie Byng's sheet. And when Reggie got up to his room in the small hours of the morning and found the thing a mass of knots, he jumped to the conclusion, being a simple-hearted young man, that his bosom friend, Jack Ferris, who had come up from London to see Lord Belpher through the trying experience of a coming-of-age party, had done it as a practical joke, and went and poured a jug of water over Jack's bed. This is life, just one long succession of misunderstandings and rash acts and what not. Absolutely. Albert was becoming impatient. He was in the position of a great general, who thinks out some wonderful piece of strategy and can't get his army to carry it out. Many boys, seeing Plummer enter the room below and listening at the keyhole, and realizing that George must have hidden somewhere and deducing that he must be out on the balcony, would have been baffled as to how to proceed. Not so, Albert. To dash up to Reggie Byng's room and strip his sheet off the bed and tie it to the bedpost, and fashion a series of knots in it and lower it out of the window, took Albert about 3 minutes. His part in the business had been performed without a hitch. And now George, who had nothing in the world to do but the childish task of climbing up the sheet, was jeopardizing the success of the whole scheme by delay. Albert gave the sheet an irritable jerk. It was the worst thing he could have done. George had almost made up his mind to take a chance when the sheet was snatched from his grasp as if it had been some live thing deliberately eluding his clutch. The thought of what would have happened had this occurred when he was in mid-air caused him to break out in a cold perspiration. He retired a pace and perched himself on the rail of the balcony.
"Psst," said Albert. "It's no good saying psst," rejoined George in an annoyed undertone. "I could say psst. Any fool could say psst."
Albert, he considered, in leaning out of the window and saying psst, was merely touching the fringe of the subject. It is probable that he would have remained seated on the balcony rail, regarding the sheet with cold aversion, indefinitely, had not his hand been forced by the man, Plummer. Plummer, during these last minutes, had shot his bolt. He had said everything that a man could say, much of it twice over, and now he was through. All was ended. The verdict was in. No wedding bells for Plummer.
"I think," said Plummer gloomily, and the words smote on George's ears like a knell, "I think I'd like a little air."
George leaped from his rail like a hunted grasshopper. If Plummer was looking for air, it meant that he was going to come out on the balcony. There was only one thing to be done. It probably meant the abrupt conclusion of a promising career, but he could hesitate no longer. George grasped the sheet. It felt like a rope of cobwebs, and swung himself out. Maud looked out on the balcony. Her heart, which had stood still when the rejected one opened the window and stepped forth to commune with the shooting stars, beat again. There was no one there. Only emptiness and Plummer.
"This," said Plummer, somberly, gazing over the rail into the darkness, "is the place where that fellow, what's his name, jumped off in the rain of the thingamy, isn't it?"
Maud understood now, and a thrill of the purest admiration for George's heroism swept over her. So, rather than compromise her, he had done Leonard's leap. How splendid of him! If George, now sitting on Reggie Byng's bed, taking a rueful census of the bits of skin remaining on his hands and knees after his climb, could have read her thoughts, he would have felt well rewarded for his abrasions.
"I've a jolly good mind," said Plummer, "to do it myself."
He uttered a short, mirthless laugh.
"Well, anyway," he said recklessly, "I'll jolly well go downstairs and have a brandy and soda."
Albert finished untying the sheet from the bedpost and stuffed it under the pillow.
"And now," said Albert, "for a quiet smoke in the scullery."
These massive minds require their moments of relaxation. End of chapter 13.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Damsel in Distress by P.G. Wodehouse, as read for LibriVox by Madame Tusk. www.rlowalrus.sitesled.com. Chapter 14. George's idea was to get home. Quick. There was no possible chance of a second meeting with Maud that night. They had met and had been whirled asunder. No use to struggle with fate. Best to give in and hope that another time fate would be kinder. What George wanted now was to be away from all the gay glitter and the fairy-like tout ensemble in the galaxy of fair women and brave men, safe in his own easy-chair, where nothing could happen to him. A nice sense of duty would, no doubt, have taken him back to his post in order to fully earn the sovereign which had been paid to him for his services as temporary waiter, but the voice of duty called to him in vain. If the British aristocracy desired refreshments, let them get it for themselves, and like it, he was through. But if George had for the time being done with the British aristocracy had not done with him. Hardly had he reached the hall when he encountered the one member of the order whom he would most gladly have avoided. Lord Belpher was not in genial mood. Late hours always made his head ache, and he was not a dancing man, so that he was by now fully as weary of the fairy-like tout ensemble as was George. But, being the centre and cause of the night's proceedings, he was compelled to be present to the finish. He was in the position of captains who must be last to leave their ships, and of boys who stand on burning decks whence all but they had fled.
He had spent several hours shaking hands with total strangers and receiving with a frozen smile their felicitations on the attainment of his majority, and he could not have been called upon to meet a larger horde of relations than had surged around him that night if he had been a rabbit. The Belpher connection was wide, straggling over most of England, and first cousins, second cousins, and even third and fourth cousins had debouched from practically every county on the map and marched upon the home of their ancestors. Like the heroine of his sister Maud's favourite poem, he was a-weary, a-weary, and he wanted a drink. He regarded George's appearance as exceedingly opportune. "Get me a bottle of champagne and bring it into the library." "Yes, sir." The two words sound innocent enough, but wishing, as he did, to efface himself and avoid publicity, they were the most unfortunate which George could have chosen. If he had merely bowed acquiescence and departed, it was probable that Lord Belpher would not have taken a second look at him. Percy was in no condition to subject everyone he met to a minute scrutiny. But when he had been addressed for an entire lifetime as Your Lordship, it startles you when a waiter calls you Sir. Lord Belpher gave George a glance in which reproof and pain were nicely mingled emotions, quickly supplanted by amazement. A gurgle escaped him. "Stop!" he cried as George turned away. Percy was rattled. The crisis found him in two minds. On the one hand, he would have been prepared to take oath that this man before him was the man who had knocked off his hat in Piccadilly. The likeness had struck him like a blow the moment he had taken a good look at the fellow. On the other hand, there was nothing which is more likely to lead one astray than a resemblance. He had never forgotten the horror and humiliation of the occasion, which had happened in his 14th year, when a motherly woman at Paddington Station had called him "dearie" and publicly embraced him, on the erroneous supposition that he was her nephew, Philip. He must proceed cautiously. A brawl with an innocent waiter, coming on the heels of that infernal episode with the policeman, would give people the impression that assailing the lower orders had become a hobby of his. "Sir," said George politely. His brazen front shook Lord Belpher's confidence. "I haven't seen you before, have I?" was all he could find to say. "No, sir," replied George smoothly. "I am only temporarily attached to the castle staff." "Where do you come from?" "America, sir." Lord Belpher started. "America?" "Yes, sir. I am in England on a vacation. My cousin Albert is page boy at the castle, and he told me there were a few vacancies for extra help tonight. So I applied and was given the job." Lord Belpher frowned perplexedly. It all sounded entirely plausible, and, what was satisfactory, the statement could be checked by application to Keggs, the butler. And yet there was a lingering doubt. However, there seemed nothing to be gained by continuing the conversation. "I see," he said at last. "Well, bring that champagne to the library as quick as you can." "Very good, sir." Lord Belpher remained where he stood, brooding. Reason told him he ought to be satisfied, but he was not satisfied. It would have been different had he not known that this fellow with whom Maud had become entangled was in the neighbourhood, and if that scoundrel had had the audacity to come and take a cottage at the castle gates, why not the audacity to invade the castle itself? The appearance of one of the footmen on his way through the hall with a tray gave him the opportunity for further investigation. "Send Keggs to me." "Very good, Your Lordship." An interval and the butler arrived. Unlike Lord Belpher, late hours were no hardship to Keggs. He was essentially a night-blooming flower. His brow was as free from wrinkles as his shirt front. He bore himself with the conscious dignity of one who, while he would have freely admitted he did not actually own the castle, was nevertheless aware that he was one of its most conspicuous ornaments. "You wish to see me, Your Lordship?" "Yes, Keggs, there are a number of outside men helping here tonight, aren't there?" "Indubitably, Your Lordship. The unprecedented scale of the entertainment necessitated the engagement of a certain number of supernumeraries," replied Keggs with an easy fluency which Reggie Byng, now cooling his head on the lower terrace, would have bitterly envied. "In the circumstances, such an arrangement was inevitable." "You engaged all these men yourself?" "In a manner of speaking, Your Lordship, and for all practical purposes, yes. Mrs. Digby, the housekeeper, conducted the actual negotiations in many cases, but the arrangement was in no instance considered complete until I had passed each applicant." "Do you know anything of an American who says he's the cousin of the page boy?" "The boy Albert did introduce a nominee whom he stated to be his cousin, home from New York on a visit and anxious to oblige. I trust he has given no dissatisfaction, Your Lordship. He seemed a respectable young man." "No, no, not at all. I merely wish to know if you knew him. One can't be too careful." "No, indeed, Your Lordship." "That's all, then. Thank you, Your Lordship." Lord Belpher was satisfied. He was also relieved. He felt that prudence and a steady head had kept him from making himself ridiculous. When George presently returned with the life-saving fluid, he thanked him and turned his thoughts to other things. But if the young master was satisfied, Keggs was not. Upon Keggs a bright light had shone. There were few men, he flattered himself, who could more readily put two and two together and bring the sum to a correct answer. Keggs knew of the strange American gentleman who had taken up his abode at the cottage down by Platt's farm. His looks, his habits, and his motives for coming there had formed food for discussion throughout one meal in the servants' hall. A stranger, whose abstention from brush and palette showed him to be no artist, being an object of interest. And while the solution, put forward by a romantic lady's maid, a great reader of novelettes, that the young man had come there to cure himself of some unhappy passion by communing with nature, had been scoffed at by the company, Keggs had not been so sure that there might not be something in it. Later events had deepened his suspicion, which now, after this interview with Lord Belpher, had become certainty. The extreme fishiness of Albert's sudden production of a cousin from America was so manifest that only his preoccupation at the moment when he met the young man could have prevented him seeing it before. His knowledge of Albert's told him that, if one so versed as that youth in the art of swank had really possessed a cousin in America, he would long ago have been boring the servants' hall with fictions about the man's wealth and importance. For Albert not to lie about a thing practically proved that thing non-existent. Such was the simple creed of Keggs. He accosted a passing fellow servitor. "Seen young blighted Albert anywhere, Freddy?" It was in this shameful manner that that mastermind was habitually referred to below stairs. "Seen him going into the scullery not half a minute ago," replied Freddy. "Thanks. So long," said Freddy. "Be good," returned Keggs, whose mode of speech among those of his own world differed substantially from that which he considered it became him to employ when conversing with the titled. The fall of great men is but too often due to the failure of their miserable bodies to give the necessary support to their great brains. There are some, for example, who say that Napoleon would have won the Battle of Waterloo if he had not had dyspepsia. Not otherwise was it with Albert on that present occasion. The arrival of Keggs found him at a disadvantage. He had been imprudent enough, on leaving George, to endeavour to smoke a cigar purloined from the box which stood hospitably open on a table in the hall. But for this, who knows with what cunning counter-attacks he might have foiled the butler's onslaught. As it was, the battle was a walk-over for the enemy. "I've been looking for you, young blighted Albert," said Keggs coldly. Albert turned a green but defiant face to his foe. "Oh, go boil your head!" he advised. "Never mind about my head. If I was to do my duty to you, I'd give you a clip the side of your head. That's what I'd do." "Then bury it in the woods," added Albert, wincing, as the consequences of his rash act swept through his small form like some nauseous tidal wave. He shut his eyes. It upset him to see Keggs shimmering like that. A shimmering butler is an awful sight. Keggs laughed a hard laugh. "Ha! You and your cousins from America."
"What about my cousin from America?"
"Yes, what about them? That's just what Lord Belpher and me have been asking ourselves." "I don't know what you're talking about."
"You soon will, young blighted Albert. Who sneaked that American fellow into the house to meet Lady Maud?"
"I never." "Think I didn't see through your little game? Why, I knew from the first."
"Yes, you did. Then why did you let him in the place?"
Keggs snorted triumphantly.
"There, you admit it. It was that fella."
Too late Albert saw his false move, a move which, in a normal state of health, he would have scorned to make, just as Napoleon, minus a stomachache, would have scorned the blunder that sent his cuirassiers plunging to destruction in the sunken road.
"I don't know what you're talking about," he said weakly.
"Well," said Keggs, "I haven't time to stand here chatting with you. I must be going back to his lordship to tell him of the horrid trick you played on him." A second spasm shook Albert to the core of his being. The double assault was too much for him. Betrayed by the body, the spirit yielded.
"You wouldn't do that, Mr. Keggs."
There was a white flag in every syllable.
"I would if I did my duty."
"But you don't care about that," urged Albert ingratiatingly.
"I'll have to think it over," mused Keggs. "I don't want to be hard on a young boy."
He struggled silently with himself. Ruining his prospects. An inspiration seemed to come to him.
"All right, young blighted Albert," he said briskly. "I'll go against me better nature this once and chance it.
And now, young fella, me lad, you just hand over that ticket of yours. You know what I'm alluding to. That ticket you had at the sweep, the one with Mr. X on it. Albert's indomitable spirit triumphed for a moment over his stricken body. That's likely, ain't it? Keggs sighed. The sigh of a good man to help a fellow being, and has been baffled by the other's perversity. Just as you please, he said sorrowfully. But I did hope I shouldn't have to go to his lordship and tell him how you've deceived him. Albert capitulated. Here you are. A piece of paper changed hands. It's men like you what lead to half the crime in the country. Much obliged, me lad. You'd walk a mile in the snow, you would, continued Albert, pursuing his train of thought, to rob a starving beggar of a halfpenny. Who's robbing anyone? Don't you talk so quick, young man. I'm doing the right thing by you. You can have my ticket marked Reggie Byng. It's a fair exchange, and no one the worse. Fat lot of good that is. That's as it may be. Anyhow, there it is. Keggs prepared to withdraw. You're too young to have all that money, Albert. You wouldn't know what to do with it. It wouldn't make you happy. There's other things in the world besides winning sweepstakes. And properly speaking, you ought never to have been allowed to draw at all, being so young. Albert groaned hollowly. When you finish talking, I wish you'd kindly have the goodness to leave me alone. I'm not myself. That, said Keggs cordially, is a bit of luck for you, my boy. Except my heartiest felicitations. Defeat is the test of the great man. Your true general is not he who rides to triumph on the tide of an easy victory, but the one who, when crushed to earth, can bend himself to the task of planning methods of rising again. Such a one was Albert, the page boy. Observe Albert in his attic bedroom scarcely more than an hour later. His body has practically ceased to trouble him, and his soaring spirit has come into its own again. With the exception of a now very occasional spasm, his physical anguish has passed, and he is thinking hard. On the chest of drawers is a grubby envelope addressed in an ill-formed hand to Reggie Byng, Esquire. On a sheet of paper, soon to be placed in the envelope, are written in the same hand these words: Do not fear, remember. Faint, F-A-N-T, heart, H-A-R-T, never won, W-O-N, fair lady. I shall watch your futur, F-U-T-U-R, progress with considerable interest. Your well-wisher. The last sentence is not original. Albert's Sunday school teacher said it to Albert on the occasion of his taking up his duties at the castle, and it stuck in his memory. Fortunately, for it expressed exactly what Albert wished to say. From now on, Reggie Byng's progress with Lady Maud Marsh was to be the thing nearest to Albert's heart. And George, meanwhile? Little knowing how fate has changed in a flash an ally into an opponent, he is standing at the edge of the shrubbery near the castle gate. The night is very beautiful. The barked spots on his hands and knees are hurting much less now, and he is full of long, sweet thoughts. He has just discovered the extraordinary resemblance, which had not struck him as he was climbing up the knotted sheet between his own position and that of the hero of Tennyson's Maud, a poem to which he has always been particularly addicted, and never more so than during the days since he learned the name of the only possible girl. When he has not been playing golf, Tennyson's Maud has been his constant companion. Queen Rose of the Rosebud Garden of Girls, come hither, the dances are done. In glass of satin and glimmer of pearls, Queen Lily and Rose in one. Shine out, little head, sunning over with curls, to the flowers and be their sun. The music from the ballroom flows out to him through the motionless air. The smell of sweet earth and growing things is everywhere. Come into the garden, Maud, for the black bat, night, hath flown. Come into the garden, Maud, I am here at the gate all alone. And the woodbine spices are wafted abroad, and the musk of the rose is blown. He draws a deep breath. Misled young man, the night is very beautiful. It is near to the dawn now, and in the bushes live things are beginning to stir and whisper. Maud! Surely she can hear him. Maud! The silver stars look down dispassionately. This sort of thing had no novelty for them. End of chapter 14.